Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Certification, International Certification and Taxation. This is our fourth year that we're running this program. We did this in conjunction with the Ministry of Financial Services. At that time, Mr. Ryan Pinder was the Minister of Financial Services. This was just before VAT was implemented. He saw the need to run a tax course. Today, we're going to start a little unorthodox. We're going to be starting with Module 3. Okay? Module 3 deals with trust, basically. We're not doing you any disservice, okay? Because of scheduling conflicts, that's why we're starting with the trust section for the next 3 weeks. Actually, we have class this Saturday.
Next Saturday.
We skip the 17th. The reason we skip the 17th, that's our graduation. Okay, and then we're back on the 24th. Then after that, we're on every other Saturday. Every Saturday.
Okay.
Sorry, until I think December 3rd, something like that. The exam consists of 70 questions. 35 questions comes from this section, trust. Okay?
Wink, wink.
Yeah, all right. So, this is a very important module. The exam is open book, but folks, please do not let that fool you, okay? This exam, this course is not a walk in the park, all right? Go ahead. You don't have module 3?
No. Because I remember you had said that you'd give us some of it, and you would give us the rest, so I don't know.
I think I'm missing module 2. You missed module 3 as well?
No, 2. Mm-hmm.
Hold on 1 second.
Oh, this is in here. Okay. It's in this one here. Module
3. Double check. 1, 2. Please. Yeah.
Thank you. Module 2
is missing. Module 2 is missing. Yeah, I sort of like module 2 is missing because Mr. Pinder is updating that section for us, okay? As I said, this exam is
so this exam is like questions then that we're gonna
yeah, it's not questions. Like fill in the blanks. You have to understand the concept, okay?
It is fill in the blanks?
No.
Oh
no, does you know what I mean? Like you could go through the book and say, okay, I see it. This is 50,000 whatever it is. Blank. It's A, B, or C. You have to understand the concept. I know some of you have done a certified financial planner, so you should be familiar as to how the question is set up. It's all multiple choice. Okay. What else?
Passing
mark is 65%. So that's about, I believe it's either 47 to 49 correct out of the 70. And it's a 2-hour exam. It's done online. You get your results right away.
The exam is done online?
Yes, done. I mean, when I say done online, on a laptop, it's computerized, computer-based. Okay? And you get your results at the end. As I said, folks, although it's open book, don't let that fool you. Okay? You have to understand.
Yeah. Practice
exams? There is a mock exam, folks. But that mock exam only gives you an idea how the exam is laid out. Questions are, you know what I mean, the questions don't justify, well, I just say, it gives you an idea of what it looks like, basically, okay? But we will record every class will be placed on YouTube, so if you do miss one, please go back and use the video as your view, okay? Do your best to try to make every class. Okay? If you can. As I said, it's a very difficult exam. But at the end of the day, it'll worth your time and efforts. Any questions? Everybody looks so down and out. I didn't start off too negative.
Don't worry, I'll be joining you guys in this class. I'll be suffering along with you.
But I can't help you because I don't know nothing much about anything. All right? I read the stocks policy. I said, you know what? I need Googling and YouTubing. All right?
So the exam is on that Friday.
Well, here's the deal. We have a date schedule.
Okay.
All right? Once we have completed, if we have to have review classes, you understand what I'm trying to say? It's tentative. Once we are finished, we want to get the exam done before December 15th. Mm-hmm. Okay? Mm-hmm. We want to do the exam before Christmas.
Right.
All right?
And it's going to be on a Friday or a Saturday. And I'll tell you why I'm asking.
Mm-hmm.
I have an exam to take on the 4th of December.
Which is a Saturday.
Yeah, which is a Saturday. So I thought that this one was going to be on that Friday. So that's just what I was asking in terms of planning it, you know.
We always work around that.
Okay,
So in the last 2 weeks, we locked on a date.
And then I go and shop for the next weekend.
All right.
Don't have it that Saturday.
So I'll go ahead and turn it over to Ms. Archer.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll go ahead and start.
He needs a hold.
And the sign and cheese.
Where's the sign and cheese?
Sorry. There is more material. We're giving you to you on a jump drive, okay?
Okay.
This is a little off the print up. Right?
So all of the material has to be on the jump drive, which is some of it is a duplication of what's in the binder.
Mm-hmm.
All of that goes to the exam in the same material.
Okay.
So if you come from okay. Let us wait for the calendar season class. But we're gonna start today because Mr. Pender is not here to do the introduction. I'm gonna start with the easier out of the topics. So I'm gonna start with administration of the state. In the same section.
Administration of the
state. Offshore trust and company.
You have a page. You have a page number.
Yeah.
It's at the end.
Page.
It doesn't have a page number.
It's at this
page.
Hold on. About death and taxes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, but he's in the class. So I'm in the yeah. He has to take this exam.
Why you keep smiling?
Because they have no idea what this exam is.
This is my second round. It's tough.
This course?
What? That exam, it's set by London, and trust me, it's not perfect.
So it ain't too late for us to leave now.
It's a challenge. And the rest of your classmates, they must come
in. I hope so.
Maybe
they need to
come.
Yes, they do. I don't know if they're just taking the exam or
what. No,
but
they should come and
to
come
to
the class
again.
How was
that?
Say what?
What you get?
It's a loan application. So it's not going to memorize, and it's being able to apply it, being able to understand it. Okay? Let me see how long it's going to take.
The questions are straightforward.
No.
So you just keep sharing those tips.
I can let you use this binder. So this morning we're going to talk about wills, intestate succession, and probate. Anyone can tell me what that means?
I guess wills is wills. Intestate means when you die without one, and what happens when it's okay. And probate is when you would, is it when it goes to the courts?
When you administer the estate. Okay.
Is it that any wills were written after the previous one?
The one that appears.
Yeah.
Say that again.
The probate, I guess, is the process in which you, like, let's say there's a lady, she dies, she wrote a will, she wrote a will in 2010, and then she wrote a will in 2013. Mm-hmm. The probate would find out if there's any other wills or any other, I guess, claims on her property or anything like that to see which one would be the most dated and the one that would be honored.
Okay, all right, so that's an example of a probate covers whether or not a person died testate or intestate. Okay, so it covers all of it. What that means? Why aren't we moving? Aha!
Okay.
Yeah. See, that's my job. I have to find a cartoon.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So when a person dies, matters relating to his property have to be resolved. And the basic problem is that property belonging to the deceased at the date of his death remains in his name. And if there's no one who, without the some further procedure, is entitled to deal with it. So when a person dies with a will, the administrator can take effect immediately. Without a will, it has to go to probate first. So the law lays down how his assets are to be applied and sets out the procedures that have to be followed. And this whole procedure is called administration of estates. So when a person dies, the first thing you ask, is there a valid will? And you know in this culture, the first thing someone dies, someone says there's a will. Just like she said, someone wrote a will last year. No, I heard she just wrote one last week. There's always a discussion. So if there is a will, then there will be a testate succession, which means they died with a will. And this will follow the administration of estates. But if there's not a valid will, then the person died intestate. And that will follow the rules under the Inheritance Act. So whether you die with a will or without a will, that is, you died. Whether you died with a will or without a will, that is, you died testate or intestate.
Right.
Okay? The persons that are responsible for dealing with your estate is called a personal representative. So that personal representatives. Is the term that is used for both the executives and the administrators. If you die with a will, that is, testate, then in your will you would appoint an executor or an executrix. If you died without a will, you died intestate, and the court will appoint an administrator.
How does that work out now? I'm sure that takes forever if the courts appoint that.
it depends on whether or not it's one that's in dispute or not. If it's simple, it doesn't take long.
Process.
Mm-hmm. Then it's contentious, then it does take a while. Then families are arguing. Okay? So the executors are appointed by the testator in the will, like I said, and then administrators are those who administer the deceased, and they're appointed by the court. So you have to be very careful when someone dies, and you take it upon yourself to act as if you are the personal representative. Because then you become liable. So what were the assets of the deceased? The assets that belonged to the deceased at the time of his death comes under the control of the personal representatives, except for jointly owned property. Why is that?
Because the other person's alive.
Hmm?
The other person's alive, I'm assuming.
No, it doesn't matter where they're alive. It was jointly owned.
Mm-hmm.
Passes to the survivor.
Right. Oh, I see, yes.
Yes, passes to the survivor.
Okay.
Unless otherwise stated in the will.
No,
it's
jointly owned. That's different.
Oh, because there was like bank accounts, which automatically assume that if one person dies, the other one gets whatever's
in the will. That depends.
Okay.
What do you mean, yeah?
Why
because I think there are.
Because under the law of trust, if I establish an account and I put you onto the account for the sole purpose for you just to pay my bills,
right,
because I'm incapable of going to do these things, that doesn't necessarily
right
mean that
just
is yours. The family can challenge it and say, you're put on just for a matter of convenience.
Right.
For you to get that, you have to be able to bring evidence to say, guess what? She said, in front of these people, and each one of them can witness that she said that when I put this money in the account, this is to pay my bills. But if I, when I die, I want you to have it for taking care of me.
Mm-hmm.
So if you cannot bring that evidence, that is not your money. It can be challenged.
Mm-hmm.
But behemoths don't like to go to court much.
Mm-hmm.
No, they don't. A lot of people put persons on for convenience.
Mm-hmm.
But in other parts of the world, they challenge them for that money.
Mm-hmm.
So wait. So people just put people on joint accounts for convenience.
Yeah.
But I'm thinking like married people.
No, I'm thinking like grandmother. And
grandmother.
Grandson. You know, they
okay. Say you have a relative who has no children.
Uh huh.
Right. They're like 70 years old, maybe going on 80.
Mm-hmm.
They're not gonna be tripping back and forth to the bank.
Yeah.
They're not gonna be going to the food store. They're not gonna do that. So they'll find you. You're my nice nephew, Miguel.
Mm-hmm.
Let me put you on my bank account.
Okay.
I want you to
okay
pay my bills for me. Go to the food store.
Okay.
So when you go there, they say, here, Miguel, see, this is the light bill and the water bill, my boy. Pay these for me. You go to the bank, you draw it off. But they didn't put you there to take their money.
Yeah.
Which is what happens.
And this is what happens here. What behemoths do say automatically, say, oh, I'm on the joint account.
Yeah.
When they die, it was all
yeah
mine. But you can be challenged. Because
yeah,
if that person never said that this money is for you when I die, then it's not yours. And there are a lot of cases around the world where people are challenged.
So is that like a form of power of attorney?
More or less,
yeah.
Because it becomes a you say and I say. But what you start finding, people who have joint accounts with other people, is they start to take off the money before they die.
Mm-hmm.
So that doesn't die as much.
Exactly.
So say if I'm taking care of you,
mm-hmm,
and you say, let's just say we have 60,000 when we first opened this account.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that going back and forth, taking you to the doctor, you ain't getting much longer to live. So I started asking you what kind of funeral you want and find out how much it costs. So like, no, I gotta be 20 in there for that.
Mm-hmm.
Spend the rest.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So when the family come, there ain't nothing yet to come for.
Yeah.
That's a question.
Mm-hmm.
From the bank perspective, if we have a joint account and it
mm-hmm
doesn't specifically state,
it won't state that.
Who's the owner of the source of the funds? Then if I'm legally signed onto the account, aren't the funds legally mine and the bank's
me? Yes, but I'm saying now the family can challenge
it. They can be challenged.
Because when the family member challenges and they say, guess what? My aunt never intended for her to have this money.
So they have to prove themselves then?
Yes.
As opposed to me having to prove.
Right. So when they would ask, when they would get a subpoena for the bank would be able to say, guess what? The source of all this income came from the aunt.
Mm-hmm.
Now for me to say it was for me, I have to be able to bring evidence.
Mm-hmm.
And in some cases you see where a neighbor, probably the deceased's very good friend who's to visit often,
mm-hmm,
would come and say, she always said, when I die, because she took such good care of me, I wanted her to have this money. Then the judge would weigh the two. Now, if you are a family member who never visited the woman, just coming for the first time, they're going to say no.
Who's going to say no?
The courts, yeah.
Okay.
Because they'll weigh the woman, the person who actually took care of the woman all of that time, and they weigh it. But in most instances, when they have joint account here, they just take the money and go. But people don't challenge it. They don't want to pay all that money. Okay? So what else is not included is when there is a nomination. So when you have insurance policies or insurance coverage at work, those are not included in the will. Okay? We call those nominations.
Okay, that'll just go on to whoever's name is.
Whoever's named in it, yes.
Okay.
And any benefits under a pension scheme, they're not included in the will. That's another nomination. So you can't nominate Sue under the pension plan and then put it in your will to give it to Will. That don't work. It is as stated. Okay? And any property the deceased left us as a trust for a trustee does not form part of his estate or past his personal representative. So you can, within your will, create a trust. And so those assets are removed from the will. And they go to the creation of the trust.
Now, a question about that trust and will situation.
Mm-hmm.
You're saying that if there's a will, you can set aside assets that you hold separately in a trust.
You can actually
in the
put that in the will, that you want a trust created, and which assets you want to be transferred into that
trust
on behalf of whomever you want them for.
On the understanding that what you're putting in that trust is yours.
Mm-hmm.
As opposed to...
But it can't be any of those exceptions.
Okay, maybe I'm speaking ahead of myself, but maybe I just had an example that I was thinking of.
Give me an example.
I was thinking, let's say you had a husband and a wife.
Mm-hmm.
She is writing her will. Let's say coming into the marriage, she brought some property.
Mm-hmm.
That she wants to make provisions for in her will. But I mean, as a husband, would he not have some sort of claim to that property, even though she would have brought it into the marriage? I don't know, that's what I'm asking. Can she then put that in her trust without him? He may contest, he may say, well, she couldn't have put it in trust because we were married for 30 or 40 years, so when she died, that should have been mine.
No. Mm-mm. You can go and purchase a piece of property
and
put
it
in the trust
aside.
Now.
No,
you
I see.
Can
okay.
do that.
No,
the only argument comes is when it is the matrimonial home.
I see.
That's when either spouse will argue. Because
yeah,
normally when one spouse dies, the
yeah.
matrimonial home stays for the surviving spouse.
Mm-hmm.
Now you can put it in your will where you can put the matrimonial home within the will, and I say you can stay there for the rest of your life.
Right.
Which means you cannot put that home in your will. It passes on to someone else.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a maximum of a third or something like that under law that if it's sold.
Yeah, you give them an input. Hopefully you do that when they die.
Yeah.
You word it in a way where you say you stay here for the rest of your, the remainder of your life.
And you could say unmarried.
And unmarried, yeah.
Okay.
You could put phrases in it. Or you could put
it's
in your will rather than leaving them anything. You could just say, I leave them my spouse $1.
And then you don't want to stay in the house?
No, it's a matrimonial home. He can stay in the home. Depends. He may have moved out. Does he move out? Just leave him a dollar.
But according to law, is it so that as soon as he gets, well, when he gets married, does that now have to go through another process? Or just as long as he is unmarried?
You mean when he gets married and he has to move out?
Okay. I mean, even if it's not in the will, but that's a matrimonial home,
mm-hmm.
and he gets remarried. Does the process stay?
If it's not, if what do you mean? If the matrimonial home is not in the will, he
right.
stays in the house.
Right.
And because it's not, depends. If the person died without a will,
mm-hmm.
then he's only entitled to half.
Once he gets married.
So the children gets their half. Yeah.
Once he gets
half
remarried.
Of everything that you own.
This is once he gets remarried or just unmarried?
No, that's his then. The remarriage mm-hmm. doesn't count.
Okay.
It's just that if you die without a will,
mm-hmm.
your spouse gets half
mm-hmm.
of everything that you own.
Okay. So I have a question. Let's say you were married. You purchased this property before you got married,
mm-hmm.
and then you passed away, you had a will, but in the will you left the house not to your spouse, but to your offspring or your mother. What would happen
if
then?
If you were living in it?
You were...
With him?
I guess you were living in it
then
for
a
while.
Then it becomes a matrimonial home. It changes from just a piece of property to a matrimonial home.
Okay.
That's why you see it's always wise if a woman has a home to move into the man's house.
Okay.
Rather than the other way around.
Okay.
Sorry for your nails.
I lost.
She gave some good advice.
It's my rejection.
Right,
completely.
explain. Why? I mean, for whose benefit? I mean, is
it could be either way. It could be either way.
Oh, I still lost.
When you have a house,
uh-huh.
and
okay.
you marry someone,
mm-hmm.
you put them in that house.
Okay.
It changes from just a piece of property to
a
matrimonial home.
Regardless of if that's his house or her house.
Yeah,
right.
It becomes a
okay.
matrimonial home. If you have another house, say on Exoma. That you all go to every year,
right?
Right?
Mm-hmm.
You may own that along with her, your business partner. But every year,
mm-hmm.
you have your 3 months, they have their 3 months, and you go there. That also becomes a part of your matrimonial property, and she's accustomed to that way of life.
Mm-hmm.
However you, whatever way you treat your spouse during the marriage,
mm-hmm.
whatever you are accustomed to,
mm-hmm.
they can challenge the will.
So I have a question then.
That's why these women are always maintained. Because you can challenge, he didn't leave me sufficient within the will. I go to the hairdresser, I get a pedicure, I get my clothes done, I get my massages, I have my vacation in Europe, I have a dress for every ball, I have my children, they go to swimming, they go to this, they go to that, they go to this school, you know, all of that.
Okay, I got a headache.
And is it just at the time of death? In the fact that people that homes when you are married, we might start off in one, move to another one. By the time one of us die in the other home, that's the first home. Say it was
that won't be a matrimonial home, it's where you're living now.
Yes,
that,
at the time of death.
Mm-hmm. That's your matrimonial home.
It is.
No, I'm sorry. So
yes.
If she owned the property prior to the marriage, and then after they get married, they move in there with the property, everything is still in her name, that still becomes...
Yes, yeah, but I still have rights.
That's,
you know,
yeah,
I have rights.
Right.
I have rights. It's my matrimonial home.
That's right.
And
you
have to be very
even
careful.
If she
okay.
The will doesn't override.
You can challenge
it.
Yeah. Okay, so say you take your example. This is my home. This is my home.
Right.
Then you decide you married Miguel. He moves in.
Right.
Okay, so let's say you're making 90,000.
Right.
Miguel making 40. You're making much more.
Right.
Right? But Miguel, he decides he'll paint the wall. He'll do some flowers around.
Right.
When you come home, you're so tired, you say you ain't doing all that gym thing.
Right.
He massages your feet for you.
Okay.
He runs your bath for you.
Right.
He's getting interest in that house.
Yeah. So running one bath,
strange things happen.
So for your matrimony,
people are going to fight for their rights.
Okay, then you have to say the matrimonial home, let's say if I die, it's my property and I die. So he automatically gets half of it. Even though I might have a will say I want to leave it to my children.
Yeah, but this is where he lives.
Okay.
You can't put him out.
I know, but I don't want to
afterwards.
Put him out. I just want, like, in the, he could, like you say,
he could live there until he dies.
And then I
or
want to
unless
pass
he marries, and then you pass it on to your children.
So I could do it that way.
Yeah.
Right. Okay, that's fine.
Yeah.
Well, you stay there. But he will write him tonight.
Okay.
No,
he's
out.
Okay, so though there may be some assets that don't pass on to the personal representatives, they are still brought into account for inheritance tax. So you know in Bahamas we don't have inheritance tax, but in London, Canada, United States,
yes.
You'll see when Miguel gives you the flash drive. For this topic, I've given you the administration of estate taxation for the major countries in the world. Okay? So there are two separate and distinct sets of rules when ascertaining the deceased's assets. The succession rules, which determine which property passes to the personal representatives, which they can deal with. And then you have the inheritance tax rule, which determines the value of the deceased estate for inheritance tax purposes and the amount of inheritance tax payable. So the PR normally applies for the grant. The executor appoints by will apply for a grant of probate. And the ministers, they apply for a grant of letters of administration. So it's just a difference in the name. There'll be instances where the deceased died leaving a will, but an application is made for letters of administration. And this happened when an executor who dies before the deceased, or the executor wants to renounce their appointment. So you can put someone in the will and say, I nominate Edgar to be the executor. And he said, I don't want Eric. I don't want to deal with that people. So he applied to the court to renounce it. So because it's a will, you normally just apply for a probate. But because he has renounced, it then goes under letters of administration and follows a different process. So this is why sometimes you see when someone says someone died and they had a will, why take it so long? Because he could renounce. And then someone else could come forward. And let's say she comes forward and the family members challenge her. You know what? She's drinking too much. She can't. That one is renounced. Because there are different grounds which you can challenge people for executing a will. Okay? So the personal representative, they're responsible for collecting the assets of the deceased. So if someone says you are the administrator, or the will says you are the executor, it states what the assets are. You have the responsibility to go and find out if the deceased had further assets. That's your job. You also have to find out whether or not the deceased had any liabilities. Note that the executor can act in an administration from the date of death, but in practice, a grant would be granted to establish his authority. Third parties will refuse to deal with that person until the grant is obtained. Mm-hmm. So normally when someone dies, you don't take instructions from anyone until you actually have the grant in your possession. The administrator's authority derives only from the grant.
So
the executor authority is derived from the will.
Okay, so yeah, that's an actual piece of document.
Right. The administrator, that's the person who died without a will, mm-hmm. The authority comes when they actually have the grant in their hand. So the payment of debts and expenses is the first obligation of a personal representative. So you notice in the papers you normally would see a little square saying the charge for creditors, asking for all creditors to come forward. That's your window. That's why it's so important to read the papers, because all the notices are in the papers. So you have the death notice, and then you have that notice for creditors to come. Debts and expenses are to be paid in priority to any distribution to beneficiaries. So this is why sometimes when someone says, I'm going to leave you, I'm going to leave 10,000 of you in my will. Don't worry about it in there. They may even show it to you, but you may not necessarily get it, because all debts and expenses have to be paid first. Okay, so you may be left with $200, if any.
And is it true as well that executors cannot be beneficiaries of the will?
Mm-hmm.
That is true. So I can't, so my father could leave me as executrix and say, look, a third of his property goes to you.
No, you can't be benefit. You can't witness.
Sorry, I can't witness?
Witness.
If you're going to benefit. Okay, if you're benefiting.
Can't witness.
Okay, you can't witness.
Yeah. There are rules.
And executors pay a percentage as well.
Depends if they're professional.
What makes them professional?
Maybe the attorney.
Okay. Yeah, that's right. Some bank executives as well.
Yeah. Personal representatives have powers of sale which are priority over the beneficiary's claim. You understand what that means? You have assets.
Sell the assets.
They have the power to sell the assets. Mm-hmm. Cover the expenses. Again, this is why it takes long. So after debts and expenses are being paid, it is the duty of the personal representative to distribute the assets to those entitled. An estate account will have to be prepared to detail how the estate has been administered and the assets dealt with to conclude the administration. So even in the Bahamas, you don't have any taxes. At the end, the personal representative have to give an accounting to the court as to how they distributed the assets. So the person represented function is, like I say, they have to care for all of the deceased assets, they have to pay the debts and expenses, including inheritance tax in other jurisdiction, and then they distribute what remains to those who are entitled. And you remember, with the change of the law, it's all children.
Is there a time limit on my, like how you say, collecting the assets? And I say,
reasonable.
You found out that this person had an asset or had some, was entitled to something, does the executive sort of authority or power
yeah,
for that?
It continues. So let's look at what's required for a valid will, since you all want to write one tonight. So, it's always said that the will speaks from death. That's how the court interpreted it. What's written in the will is what the deceased wanted. Okay? So the matters of entitlement and the extent of the assets are determined at the date of death. So someone could walk around here every day and say, I own this property, that property, that property. What you own is established at the time of death. The testator is free to revoke and alter his will at any time before his death. And that is why there's always confusion, a lot of contention when someone dies. Because you could write a new will every day. You could alter your will every day. You can take what I'm giving this person $1,000 and change it to $3,000 and initial it and have someone witness it. Then you can go to the next month, change it to something else again. So when dealing with the question whether the will is legally valid, you have to address the situation as it was at the date the will was signed. So you go back in time.
When you speak of capacity now, you're talking about, I mean, does this talk about my ability to do that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because I'm thinking, some people depend on how old they are. I mean, they may have assets to give away. But I mean, let's use my father as an example.
Age?
He's over 70.
So
but I
good.
Think he's, yeah, but his memory's going now.
Is he diagnosed?
No. But as far as, I mean, I don't know about any bills, but my whole thing is he was looking at a granddaughter and trying to figure out who she was a couple of days ago. I mean, we know he remembers sometimes and sometimes he doesn't. So how strong is that if I were to, upon his death, present a will,
mm-hmm.
depending on whether it was on the date of it,
that
it could
wrote?
Be changed. No, that he would have written.
When? Now?
Later on now when he started to forget. How?
Mm-hmm.
What about capacity there? Could that be challenged? Let's say someone decides, well, no, how come he's giving you everything, or how come...
If a person is mentally challenged and they have moments
uh-huh.
of senility,
yeah.
it's valid.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's why I asked you to let me test it. Because if you have an actual letter from a doctor,
okay.
confirming
yes.
that he has Alzheimer's,
yes.
no. But do you have intervals of lucid moments?
Yeah.
During those lucid moments, if a doctor writes that, like how he's in that state now,
mm-hmm.
they say you take him for a physical. And the doctor said, there's nothing really wrong with your father.
Yeah.
You know, this is a normal part of aging.
Right.
And, you know, and he says, you know, notice today he's quite coherent.
Mm-hmm.
Probably the day after tomorrow he's not.
Mm-hmm.
And if he can put that in there, that yes, he does have signs of aging with memory problems, but today in my visit, he's lucid.
Okay.
Yeah, it could be valid. So he has to write it at the lucid moment. Because even though he has lucid periods, depends on what he writes.
Mm-hmm.
The other family members can challenge it.
Mm-hmm.
Because that day he didn't recognize her, tomorrow he does.
Yeah, she get everything.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what happens. Okay? So when there's dispute as to the validity of the will, inquiries have to be made as to how the events occurred. And requirements for validity is those relating to the capacity and mental state of the testator and the legal formalities which have been observed. So there's two things. Capacity and mental state, they go together. And of course, the legal formalities. So for a legal will, you have to be 18 years or older. And there is an exception under the Wills Act, which will be called privilege wills. You know what a privileged will is, right?
Yeah.
That's for those who are in the defense force.
Only the defense force?
There's military service, right?
For the police force falling up to or just defense?
More the defense
force.
Yeah. Because you're out at sea.
And what is that? What is that?
What that means is for you and I to write a will, we actually have to write it for a defense force officer. He can speak it to someone.
I see.
He can say, I'm about to die, and I
this
want you to
I
give
want.
Everything
mm-hmm.
to Helen.
Okay.
And it's valid.
When the person who calls has a certain, he can just call anyone.
Whoever, what do you mean? No.
I think, like, if they fight, no, he's about to die or something like that.
Die, yeah.
And he's telling his best
he
buddy.
He comes back, he can write a will.
Oh, okay.
I give this to you.
Yeah, hey,
yeah.
Buddy, take care of my
sure
wife. Da, da, da.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Now, let's just say you were doing.
About to
die. Wow. What's that man's name? Who's in that movie? Who's racing? Too Fast, Too Furious.
Oh, him.
Him.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
So let's just say Paul Walker said, I'm going to race this guy. And in the event I die, I want you to have my car collection.
Mm-hmm.
Race her there and he dies, you own it.
Mm-hmm. You have to be able to prove.
Yeah.
So, you have
so,
to say in front
so
of witness,
right.
I guess.
So now, not just before witnesses, you don't necessarily need witnesses, what do you need? If he says, no, if he says, if I go there and I race, and I die, and I think I could die, because I'm going to go fast. I want you to own my cars. What do you need?
A WhatsApp recorder.
Need what?
Recorder.
No.
No.
You ain't got to go that far. He just needs to give you keys.
Oh, okay. Really?
Yeah.
The keys.
That's the key. It's transfer.
Now, how was that? Privilege part, I thought it was only military.
No, we finished the military part. He was just giving another example. He's saying how you own things.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just in privilege, you just speak it. But
right,
you, a gift can also pass if someone anticipates they're going to die.
Mm-hmm.
Or the deeds, a house or something like that.
Mm-hmm. People are about to fly on the plane and they're scared to fly.
Yeah.
And they say,
right.
You're on this plane, I may die. I'm so scared of plane. I don't know, that one just crashed yesterday. In the event I die, I want you to have this. It's yours.
Do you have to put that? Like it's perfect.
We need to
you
have
it.
Chance,
you
yeah.
have
chance,
it.
Chance,
you
right.
have to have it in your hand.
No,
and
when
these
say
words. But then someone, you have to go to court and you love to challenge that. The person love to prove
okay.
that you stole it.
Wow.
What? So that's it. So testamentary intention. In order for a will to be valid, the testator must have testamentary intention. So when you say someone intended to write a will, there are things that have to be present. One, you must have capacity. The mental capacity at the time the will was executed. And the question is, did he have a sound disposing mind? The next was, did he have an intention to make a will? Because if someone is forced to write a will, the will is not valid.
Right.
If someone is coerced to write a will, it is not valid. And he must act it voluntarily and exercise his genuine free will. They sit down and say, I want to write my will. No, you keep pushing her to write your will because I think you could die. So, when we say someone has sound disposing mind, there are three tests that has to be applied. First, the person who's writing the will, the testator, or the testatrix, if it's a female, must understand the nature of his acts. He has to know that he's writing a will. He has to be aware of all of his properties. You don't need a detail. You don't have to know that it's on the corner of Armstrong and Wilton Street. He needs to know, I have a property in Madera. I have a property in Old Fort Bay. I have a property on Bay Street. And then he has to be aware of his friends and relatives. He has to know who they are. And if the testator made a valid will and then loses his capacity, he will not be able to revoke or alter the will because both acts require testamentary capacity. The mere fact that the testator suffers from a mental illness is not sufficient to render a will invalid. What matters is whether he has testamentary capacity on the above test. Did he know he was writing a will? Did he know what his assets are? that he knows friends and relatives. Neither blindness, if there is doubt, of course, we will get a marriage license. Neither blindness nor illiteracy means a testator cannot make a valid will. So a person can sit down in front of an attorney and say, this is what I want to give. The attorney can write it out and he can put an X there. It's still valid. Intoxication by alcohol, habitual drunkenness, or drug addiction, they do not deprive a person from testamentary capacity. Is there evidence that a will was executed while a testator was under the influence of either drugs or alcohol, then the person who wants to establish the will was valid must prove the testator's capacity. Old age and illness do not render a testator incapable. The question is always when someone writes a will at her father's age is whether there's undue influence or duress. So let's say if he makes it all in favor of his granddaughter, then her siblings can challenge him. Okay, so the requirements of a valid will capacity, you must have testamentary intention. The testator must have general and specific intention. He must intend to make the will, and he has to have understood and approved the contents before executing the will. The will must be voluntary and, of course, free will. There are various matters which may mean that the will is in some way defective because the testator may not have been acting voluntarily. Of course, that's undue influence. Some people put guns in people's head, or say they're going to punch them out if they don't execute the will in their favor. It could be fraud. We've had cases in the Bahamas where people created duplicate wills and many different wills, forging the testator's signature, especially when there's a lot of money involved. And the person alleging fraud and undue influence have to prove it. And this becomes the hard part. And this is why a lot of properties sitting around vacant. Because wills are being challenged. So if I'm challenging a will and I'm saying that that will is fraud, I have to prove it. And in most instances, people can't prove it.
So what I mean, if you don't prove it, then you, things move along.
You're saying most cases people can't or can't?
Can't. No, I don't know, really.
You had to practice that signature. I've seen some in the registry where they yeah, the bill moves on, where it was challenged because of fraud. A lot of assets was involved. The signature is exact.
Yeah.
And it went to a signature expert and they said it is exact. But the family insists. One person wrote that bill. Because the disposition is just so different. And the person didn't have any mental incapacity.
Yeah.
So
justice, no, the I would have never given it to her.
So in that situation, what do you do? She's like, what do you
got to
think
about? What are the assets? If the will
proceeds.
Yeah,
but I'm saying that whole time of challenging it for fraud takes years.
I know.
It takes years. And the instance I know now, the family is now running the business, but now they're so old and it's going down after all of that challenge.
Yeah.
It's sad. And of course there's a mistake. We challenge it as a mistake. Because you know, sometimes someone can say, I leave this to Mary, my friend. But they have three friends named Mary. Can you figure out which one? So you gotta go to court. And all say it's me. So Section 5 of the Wills Act sets out the formalities. Remember I said you can challenge the will on two grounds. One is the testamentary and mental capacity of the testator testatrix, and the second one is whether or not the actual will itself is valid. So no will is valid unless it is in writing, signed by the testator, or by some other person in his presence and by his direction. So you don't have to sign the will yourself.
But what does that mean though? Because how does an instance like that arise? Okay, I may be in a hospital.
You may not be able
I'm
to write.
Out. And so what do I, but you need witnesses to that though?
You can ask witnesses later.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
The first,
they sign this for me.
First, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
account. And what do you put, their name?
No, you sign it for them. You say for.
For. Okay.
So it has to be in writing, signed by the tester. You just worry about who will write this bill, right?
No, my thing is that same kind of like, you pass it, that seems like something that's open to challenge.
It is in writing, no, but in law, the law covers it. Okay. Signed by the testator, by some other person, in his presence,
okay,
and by his direction. It appears that the testator intended by his signature to give effect to the will. That's what it means. The signature is made or acknowledged by the testator in the presence of two or more witnesses present at the same time. But this is where wills are normally challenged. Two witnesses has to be there when the testator or the person he directs signs the will. Each witness either attests and signs the will or acknowledges his signature in the presence of the testator, but they don't have to do that in the presence of each other. You understand what that means? I hear silence on this side. What that means, Miguel?
If I get signed this one today and then somebody assigned it tomorrow, correct?
And what are you?
One of the witnesses.
Yes.
All right.
But when the testator signed, what has to happen?
They both have to be
there.
Yeah.
Looking at the document.
Mm-hmm.
Not looking on the window, not on your phone, not on the kitchen. If you are not looking at the document,
mm-hmm,
when he signs, it's not valid.
Mm-hmm.
If someone witnesses that, the will can be challenged. It is not valid. The two persons, when you are signing, must be there on either side watching you sign.
I'm sorry, and you said previously that the witnesses...
When I sign as the witness,
right.
If
no,
he and I are the witness, we don't have to be there at the same time to sign.
Right, but I think earlier, I don't know if you brought up the point that the witness... One of the witnesses that doesn't, must not be named in the will, right? Okay.
A will can be valid if it does not comply with Section 5, to be treated as properly executed. It can be valid if it does not comply. Therefore, it is valid if it should conform to the law of the country where the will was executed, or where at the time of the execution of the will, the testator was domiciled or habitually resident. Or where at the time of his death, the testator was domiciled, no. Or at the time of the execution, or at the time of the death, the testator was a national.
Okay, so we're going to pass on. A will can
remember
be valid.
Remember now, that what I gave you at the beginning is the formalities for law of the will in the Bahamas.
Right.
But you can write a will in another country.
Mm-hmm. Covering assets in the Bahamas.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So it says that it can be valid.
Okay.
If you were habitually resident here in the Bahamas.
Can
or you were domiciled here in the Bahamas. Just that when you probate, when you apply for probate, it follows a different process than a native person.
Okay, because I was thinking too, I know in the past, and I don't think it happens as much anymore, in the offshore banks, they used to have clients sign wills covering, I think, their assets here.
Mm-hmm. Some people do like that. They do two wills.
Right.
But some people just write one will.
Okay. Let's
and
say they
include their assets
here
in the Bahamas. And so after it's probated in their home country, they send it here to the Bahamas to be probated.
That's if they don't want the authorities to know in their home country that they have. So they probably do two separate ones if for whatever reasons they have their assets.
But now
here,
with all of the taxation, they do one document.
Okay.
So a will executed on a ship or aircraft would be valid if the execution conforms to the law of the country it is registered in or most closely connected.
Oh, the closest place, yeah, like then U.S. waters or U.S. territory or...
But normally it takes the
international
law
of the sea guy.
No, where the ship is registered.
I see.
You own a behemoth ship, you follow behemoth law.
Okay.
What happened, Monica? You did all these things?
Yes.
Yeah, everything. Yeah. A ship has a nationality of its own. If a will disposes of immovable property, it is valid if it accords with the country where the land is situated. Do you understand what that means?
No.
Immovable. So if you have a piece of property like land, it's valid if it's where the country is situated. It follows the law where that country is. In English law, the division of property is into real and personal property, freehold, and certain interests in land. Leases are personal property. You know what that means? What's real property? Land.
Land.
Yeah.
Land.
Land.
Land. Land is real.
And personal is your jewelry and all the rest of that stuff. When you talk about real property can be divided into freehold and to leases. Freehold means property that you own outright. Leases is, of course, what you lease. So they put leases on the personal property because leases go with time. Yes, Miguel?
No.
Because leases go with time.
They go with time.
So freehold would be you own that outright.
Outright.
You don't have no mortgage on that.
No.
So leases and mortgage are personal property?
Or mortgage you don't own.
Oh, yeah, that's true. That's true.
No, you don't own a mortgage.
Oh, that's the
one,
yeah. That's
until
the bank's
loan.
You pay it
off. That's the bank's loan.
Yeah.
You may have an equitable interest in a mortgage. In conflict of law, the classification of movables and immovables. So you have a land categorization of property. So in land, you say real and personal property. So when you die, they ask, when the PR does your application, you say these are your real property and these are your personal property. When you have property in other countries other than your home, then you move into whether you have movable or immovable property. And that depends on what is what they call in Latin the lex situs. Where does the property rest? And what is the law that governs that country where the property rests? We got that?
Yes. So you're okay.
So don't come back but review. Got it?
So I'm basically saying when I write my will here, disposing of property that I hold in Florida.
Now if you don't get this right, if you write in your will and you want to dispose of movable or immovable property, because you move it into a different law.
Right, so that's what I was thinking. Yeah, let's say I own, I don't want to say timeshare, but don't count. I'm talking about some land, say farmland.
So immovable.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
That would be governed, though.
By the laws of Florida.
Oh,
but it has to be executed here.
No, she can put it in her will.
Okay. But then there's some of the probate.
And after she gets the probate here, it has
to go
to Florida
for
that property. If she had property in France, it'll then have to go to France.
Right. Okay. Once
because it follows the property, that follows the law
of where it is.
Where it is.
Yeah, but you can't move
that's
it.
Why it's called lex situs. It's immovable. It follows that law.
And it has to be disposed of in your will in accordance with the law of where that property is.
But normally you would just say, I leave this property to so and so. The disposition happens when they get in that country.
They would then have to take care of it.
So the reverse, like you said, and you deal with the...
Like a foreigner who has property here?
Yeah.
When the foreigner has property here, according to our laws, they go through resealing. That's the process, we call it resealing. So all we do is we just register that the interest, the person has died, and is now going to whomever.
Okay.
But each law has its own, each country has its own law. So that's why I sent you the link that Ernst & Young has that 470 pages, and it shows you how inheritance work in the major countries around the world. This is different. The process is different. So the capacity to marry and succession rights are determined by a person's domicile. Remember, you can remember a long time people saying that when people got married, they rented this country versus that country. Everything depends on your domicile. What is the law in the country where you live? Will it recognize your marriage when you come back to where you live? That's what it's talking about domicile. And the same thing with succession rights. Your succession rights depends on where you are domiciled, where you live. That's what gives you the rights.
Not a country of which you are a citizen. I mean, like nationality. For example, I could be Canadian, but I live here. I'm domiciled in the Bahamas.
Mm-hmm.
So then that law would govern marriage for me and a will. As opposed to, because I'm a Canadian citizen, that would not supersede the fact that I'm domiciled in the Bahamas.
It depends.
Mm-hmm.
On whether you're habitual or not.
like let's say permanent residence, which actually makes you more here.
You're here,
outside.
Right. But you have some people who come here just for 3 months and 4 months,
right.
So they're what you call habitual residents. Remember, that's what Nygaard had argued when it was time for the big access? At the beginning, that he was habitual, he was not habitual in the Bahamas, that he was resident here.
Yeah.
But he had spent more time there.
Right.
Yeah. So now he spends more time here.
Yeah, so he's like, say, he's not paid those Canadian doctors.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, in English law, a person cannot be without a domicile, and you can only have one domicile at any time. So there are two forms of domicile. Domicile of origin, that's what you get when you're born. So if you're born in the Bahamas, your domicile of origin is the Bahamas. Then you could have a domicile, a child can take out a domicile of his father, if he is legitimate, or the domicile of his mother, if he is illegitimate. The domicile of origin may be replaced by a domicile of choice, that is, you decide you want to live somewhere else, you choose to live there. So they say if your job sends you on an assignment to a different country, you could decide you want to live there. That is a domicile of choice. So to have a domicile of choice, two things have to be in place. You have to have a fact of residence in a particular country, coupled with an intention to stay in that country permanently or indefinitely. Once a domicile is established, choice or origin, it will continue until changed or abandoned. If a domicile of choice is lost before another domicile of choice replaces it, you go back to your domicile of origin.
So back to the two forms of domicile.
Mm-hmm.
There's domicile of origin, and then there's domicile of choice.
You born in the Bahamas and you decided I like living in Turks and Caicos. That's my domicile of choice.
So, but the domicile of origin obtained at birth, and a child's domicile of origin is a domicile of
his
father.
If he is legitimate.
If he is legitimate.
Or of his mother.
Or his mother is
legitimate.
Can you explain that last point?
Which one?
If a domicile of choice is lost before another domicile of choice replaces it.
Okay, so say your domicile is the Bahamas, and you decided you were going to live in Turks and Caicos.
Right.
And you've been living there for 10 years. And you've said to some other people around, I don't want to live here no more. I think I'm going to move to Miami. Right?
Mm-hmm.
But you make no steps to move to Miami. You've not filled out an application form. You've not purchased any assets. So you're in between. Your domicile is the Bahamas. All of this here, but domicile comes into play when someone is moving between jurisdictions and then they die.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You have to decide what is their domicile. Because the domicile gives you the succession rights. So to know which law governs their property and their whole right to execute whatever transactions they did, you have to know where was their domicile. What law governs their will.
So say a French citizen,
mm-hmm.
sick, he applied for Swiss residence, he got Swiss residence, but he died in France before he could move to Switzerland.
Mm-hmm.
So his domicile would be in France.
Mm-hmm. Unless he had already purchased properties, he had already lived there, he already communicated. No,
yeah.
No.
Okay.
He goes back to where he was. Not that she knows something. In international matters, there's what you call habitual residence. This is a regular physical presence which must endure for some time. It's not continuous, and you just have temporary periods of absence. The element of intention is less than is required for domicile. So when it's domicile, the person actually says, this is where I intend to live. This is where I want to be. When you talk about habitual residence, this is just someone coming off and on. Habitual residence, a country may be established if a person has an intention to reside there, which is coupled with a period of actual residence. So this will be like the winter people in the Family Islands. A person may have more than one habitual residence, and a person's habitual residence may be different from his domicile. We got that?
Yeah.
Your domicile of origin, where you born, then your domicile of choice, where you decide to live, and then you can also have an habitual residence where you go and spend your mental time for 3 months. Okay? Nationality is a person's political status. So nationality may be obtained by birth, parentage, or by naturalization. A person could be a national of one country, domicile in another country, and have habitual residence in a third country. In English law, the general rule is that succession to inheritance of movable property is dealt with under the law of the testator's domicile. Get that?
Yes.
Succession to immovable property is determined, like I said, by the lex situs.
Okay, so
that's the law where the land is situated.
So the movable property testator's domicile.
So if I die and I have jewelry and I have land, the jewelry, the law governing the jewelry depends on where I am domiciled.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yes. That's
where
you
for the last. They're movable. These things you can move.
Mm-hmm.
If it's immovable, it's
yeah,
determined
it's
by where the land is situated, the lex situs. You see how the exam questions get tricky?
Mm-hmm.
So we can stop right there. Stop right there. A person, when they die, can die.
Testate
or intestate. If they die testate, that means they died with a will. If they died intestate, they died without a will. The person who administers the will is called a
executor
or executrix. The person who administers the intestate is called what?
Personal
administrator. Collectively, those two are called personal representatives. Okay, so if I die and I leave a will, and my family member says this will was not written by Christine, how can it be challenged? How can they go to the court? On what grounds?
Fraud.
Fraud is one.
Mm-hmm. Mistake.
Mistake.
Incapacity.
Incapacity. All right. So. Let's just say the will is not being challenged. We move on. I have property. What governs succession?
The lord of land?
Domicile.
Domicile.
Domicile. Where you are domiciled. And if I live in more than one country, and I have property in more than one country, what factors are taken into consideration?
The country of the property.
For the property,
mm-hmm.
Okay, you have two different ones.
Life.
Where you live
mm-hmm.
is based on real and personal property.
Right.
Property that fall outside of your jurisdiction is whether it's movable
or
immovable.
Right.
Right.
So real and personal. Say that, what is the difference again between real is...
Real is
land.
Land.
And personal be anything else.
Yeah,
your
jewelry and your clothes.
That's
movable.
Right.
Okay. And leases fall under personal property
leases,
because
okay.
You only have it for a time.
Real is only that. Real only comes into play where it's in your country.
In your country, yes. You said this is my real property and these are my personal property.
But if you have another country.
When you move into another country, it's whether you have movable or immovable assets.
Okay. And your movable depends on where you're domiciled.
Yeah. The movable and immovable property, when it comes to immovable, it bases what are called the lex situs, where
yes.
The country,
where the country is,
where the land is, yeah.
But movable depends on where you're domiciled.
Because
mm-hmm.
That gives you the succession rights.
Mm-hmm.
Your rights is based upon where you're domiciled. She look at she baby, she have a question.
No, I just trying to let all that sink in. Quite lose it.
Don't lose it.
Okay,
there can be joint bills, yes.
I think I have a question.
Go ahead.
In the case of, if the property is, like you said, immovable and movable, let's say you know, it's immovable to a property land, and it was in the process of being sold. So that taxes had started, but the person died, so that, you know, like you're getting cash for that. Then what happens?
The person represented for carry through.
Just carry through.
He manages the estate. If you have a business, say you had a shop,
right,
and you died, the personal representative will run that shop.
Okay.
That's what they will do. That's their job.
Okay.
It's like a job, but if you're a family member, you're not paid.
Mm-hmm.
You have to carry on.
Mm-hmm.
Because if I know I'm supposed to be a beneficiary of the will, and I know that the business is supposed to be mine, you cannot let that food source sit there and all the things rot. You have to go, order the stuff,
sure,
keep the people
things
on. If you see, based upon the expenses, maybe I may have to decrease the staff, you could do that.
Right.
But you have to keep that going. Otherwise, you're going to be liable.
So, following up on her question then, if in a will it says, I leave all land to son A, and the cash that I have in the bank to son B, and as she'd indicated, you're in the process of selling a piece of land, which will then, the proceeds, be converted to cash.
Don't matter.
You just continue with that if it's been started. And so the in that case, the executor can't, wouldn't then make a decision to say, well,
No, you're not making that kind of decision. No, that's already started.
So the cash flow then puts the
The same person who's getting the land.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, they would then benefit from
that. Right.
Oh, I thought
they were
already
saying
unless in the third, you could write a will whereby you can say, let's just say you had a feeling you were going to die. You know, people feel that they're going to die and don't know that they're actually going to die. You can write the bill whereby you say, in the event that the sale does not go through, the cash then goes to B.
Yes.
You can write it like that.
Oh, so you can put it in
sort.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Like some people, they do that.
Like,
some people write the bill where they say, I am going to give property A to her, and I'm going to give property B to you. In the event that she prefers to have this one, they can swap
it. On their own.
On their own.
Okay.
Even though hers may be valued $10 and hers may be valued $1 million, if they decide that,
that's
just do it.
Okay.
That's the decision. It can be done. They can just swap it. You could ask as many questions as you want.
Okay. So if the contents of your will are here, let's say something that you say in the will contradicts, for example, the movable property, and it's contrary to the laws of the land where that immovable property resides. What?
But see, when you write a will, all you say is I dispose of and bequeath to. Full stop.
Question.
Okay.
So what if you say, I bequeath to my husband in a jurisdiction where, let's say, they
husband
don't recognize that
husband
person as your husband, or...
Are we going down that road?
No, I'm just asking.
No,
I just want
to
see how it...
No, I just wanted to know, because it depends.
Because if you give
if
the name...
It's going to be very complicated, you really don't have to.
No,
it
depends, because
the name,
you know, civil partnership law is in effect in most countries, except here.
That's just an example. I was trying to find an example where it could be possible that.
But something. But you may say the person, you may say my spouse.
Right.
But in this jurisdiction, you're not recognized as a spouse.
Correct.
You're just a friend. Mm-hmm. But even though you put the qualifier spouse, you still give it to that person.
Yeah. So they would still get it.
Not if it's not recognized here, right?
No,
so
you still give it to the
name,
person.
They may not recognize your relationship.
Because you can say, I'm giving this to my good friend.
Yeah.
You may not really be a good friend.
Your best friend.
But, yeah. Or best
friend.
Yeah. People use those names.
So they just want to know who the person is, no matter what kind of qualifiers you use before it.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm saying to Tom, my sweetie Tom, or my husband Tom gets that.
But this is what that group of persons are agitating for here in the Bahamas. They want that Civil Partnership Act. So when they write their will and they say my spouse, they'll be able to inherit. Rather than writing out a will and say, I bequeath this to George, and then everybody read it, they'll say to my spouse.
So as it stands here, if they do that, then they would have to name the person. They can't just put it.
Yeah, they don't have to spouse yet.
Right. You have to give the name.
Right.
I mean, in any will, you have to put a name, or you just put.
You have to put a name.
Okay, you can't just put my son and just leave it.
No, no, only if you have one son.
Yeah.
Right. Even if you have one son.
No, you put a name.
You have to
put
the
my
name.
Son, home, and you put the name of the person.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Are there cases where, let's say, for example, you have grandchildren. Let's say you have four grandkids by your son. Your son is married. He has four grandchildren. His wife brought a child into the marriage.
Mm-hmm.
So that's it. And you basically, you own separating them. When you see them all, you have all. When you, I guess that's the importance of leaving in a will, because you might say, I leave it to my grandchildren.
It includes all.
Would that include that fifth one too?
Because everything in, when it comes to the law of succession, is how you treat people.
Right.
So if I treat you like you are my own,
then
you are my own.
Right.
Mm.
Okay.
So. Did you title something?
No, this time you children who come out of the woodwork, so to speak, and they were not recognized as that person's child. Still explain.
Mm-hmm. If they can prove it.
Mm-hmm. If they can prove that they're
you are a member of the family.
And you go on a straight, like, he was like a father to me?
More than just that.
Meaning like this man had an outside child, but to email, he had this child.
Otherwise. If you're an outside child under the Status of Children Act, you can prove that.
Okay, that's fine. No, it's not
then you become
that
a child.
Birth certificate and all that. And
there are other things to do.
But that's more relevant if the estate is being administered versus a will, right? Because he could have five children and only choose to leave the four. Just because you're a child doesn't mean you're entitled to what the other children get under the will, right?
Yes, but you can still challenge it.
Right, and you probably would you win that challenge? It was a fifth child, you say, well, I didn't leave me anything.
Yeah.
So, okay, now you can't get that.
Even though the name is not in the will?
Mm-hmm.
I'm a child.
Yeah.
And you can challenge
but
up to an equal chair, right?
Huh?
You can challenge up to an equal chair as with the other.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But in most instances, when a man has a child that he has kept secret, he has provided for that already. Mm-hmm. In most instances.
Locally?
I don't
know.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I've seen it like with our clients, you know, because they have
payments
to
them. They provide for them. They've already provided for.
I don't think they do. Now, under in
it
the case like that, if they've made separate provisions for another child,
once they die, they know. Someone will come to them and say.
So that child cannot then come and say, "Well, oh, all y'all sharing this, I want to share."
No, they normally don't, because they're already taken care of.
Okay.
So was the court order like a DNA test? I'm just trying to figure out how they prove it if this man did not take care of this child who was outside.
Yeah, that's DNA test. There's a whole series of things.
Yeah.
So the court order.
Whenever he came and he gave the woman the $300 for the school fees, or he went and paid the school fees. But she can prove it by DNA.
Yeah.
That's his child. What happened? Yes. There's no secrets no more. No, but this has been a shock to a lot of people when someone dies and they see these people coming up and they see all these children come to the funeral. Oh, like my husband. Where did they come from? And then they find out and then see the woman and say, yeah, what happened before? And then find out every 3 months he came and dropped off his $1,500.
Wow.
He didn't bother to spend no time with the child, but he paid. They're his children and they're entitled. Only thing you get is a matrimonial home.
So, would that be considered, if the children are still school age, I guess, would that be considered, I guess, can this other lady claim...
Which lady?
Them. Can she claim what you call that thing that she said earlier?
No, that's for spouse.
She has
spouse.
She has
no claim.
Okay.
No claim.
Okay, just
for the
child. No, that's for the child.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's not even for the child that's using
it.
$1,500.
He has to pay the child's school fees, send the child off to university.
So
it, don't have nothing against child. Hold that right there, because I know where you
relax
to come here.
Exactly.
He has to pay.
But he's there now.
What else to do?
Oh, you mean in terms of maintaining
so,
them?
Yes,
because
so, I'm just saying that. So you think it's right that children, let's say they were not recognized or whatever,
mm-hmm.
right? And then they come and they show up there and they want to play. But this man didn't know you and never took care of you.
Yeah,
you
but
think
it's yours.
Right?
Yeah,
you
think
it's
yours.
You
know,
it's
yours.
It's yours.
More
I'm
supposed to
be
the
right. There.
You'll be right there, right?
Yes,
right. Especially if they left funds.
Yeah.
Well, he didn't know anything.
But if they left, there are no funds, and there was just like real assets, and they'd sell the assets, and everybody just.
It depends.
What
they
got to
go. Though they don't hear any of these stuff. Because
mm-hmm.
the legitimate ones ain't gonna sell nothing for the illegitimate ones.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I know a recent case where a man had. So three legitimate children. Must have put 25 illegitimate ones. Now the illegitimate ones are claiming all over. The illegitimate ones are claiming that the last will was fraudulent. Apparently the father said to them every time they visited him,
mm-hmm.
I'm leaving you something in the will.
But he could have said that.
He
could
have said
that.
But
that's intent.
So what the children did was, the ones who visited the father gave them $10,000 each. $10,000 each.
Mm-hmm.
Just the ones who visited.
Mm-hmm.
And then all the rest, nothing. And they took all the rest of them.
Yeah.
But they're still disgruntled. The ones that got the tan.
So they need to go and get their own things, work for them, and then make proper.
They figure they should have
gotten
more.
No way, but something else was coming.
But
this
is how the law works.
They should have gotten more.
The illegitimate. The ones that visited him, they got 10,000. They wanted 25. But you have to give. This is like extortion.
No, I mean,
like,
25.
You
want
No,
just
the ones that
visited
him.
Oh,
you give them 10, then they say shut up 25, you give them 25,
they
say more 50,
exactly.
Especially when they assess how much the person was worth.
Yeah, exactly.
Do you
know
what
I mean? So that can be joint wills, mutual wills, and what we call secret trusts. So joint wills
mm-hmm.
is where two persons execute the same will, but they're treated as document wills, as separate wills.
Mm-hmm.
They write one will. Sign both names.
That could be a husband and wife with one child saying,
husband and wife.
With one child saying, I'm leaving
mm-hmm.
everything that I
yeah.
have to little Susie or something
mm-hmm.
like
you can have mutual wills. This is when will is made by two or more persons dealing with the disposal of their property, following an arrangement between them to make such wills and not to revoke them without the consent of the other. So how this works is, husband and wife write a will, and in the will, they say, if you die first, this is what I'm giving to you, and this is what I'm giving to our children. When that person dies, they cannot then take that and give it to somebody else. You have to follow the instructions from the agreement that you made originally. Now, behemoths don't make that.
No?
No.
Why?
They
would work.
No, they won't.
You don't think so?
You're dead.
You be bound by that.
Yeah, exactly. You're dead. And I still have to follow your instructions, but I gotta just have this outright? No, they ain't gonna do that.
So the question is, let's say you get your husband to sign that. Right? Unless he tried it, he won't change his mind. I'll say, no, I don't want to change my mind. Then it stands.
Yeah.
No, because he could go and write a will after that, and that will supersede anything.
No, that's
done.
No, because
no.
That's one bill for two
of you.
Both of you have to agree.
That's one time, one
day. Unless both of you go to the attorney and say, yes, we're changing this will.
That's something.
Yeah,
well,
that's
something.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, the next person.
Yes, exactly. You've got to work with nothing. So that's what I call a joint bill.
Separated, not legally, because I know a lot of persons in the office, they just.
Live together no more.
This
is legal. This is a legally married.
So that's not.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's why you need to do things properly. Because
yeah.
if he got sick,
You have
as
to take
wife,
care of him.
You're obligated to him.
Yeah.
You have to take care of him.
Yeah, so you got to make sure he's your husband and he won't benefit from him.
You just divorce them because once you keep it, you have to be the one who needs to wipe him off and bathe him off and take him to the doctor. You're
happy
still legally his wife.
Exactly.
So the spouse, they're separated, and the spouse gets sick, but the other spouse does not take care of them. Then what happens?
He was responsible.
But I mean, if you don't do it, and then they
come
around,
and
then
talk bad about you.
Yeah, they'll talk bad about you. You won't be able to hold your head up. Community is too small.
My friend's cousin, that's the situation where she died. She and I has been separated for years. And she got cancer, and the family was helping to take care of all of us, whatever. And then when she died, he went to National Insurance, got the death benefit, he went to the credit.
He's entitled.
But she was still married to him.
She's still married to him. That's
the
whole point.
Exactly.
Once you are married, you have entitlements, you have rights.
Exactly.
Now, his conscience was going to kill him because when he gets sick, no one will look after him because of the way in which he treated her.
Right.
But they are the first ones. You realize, I'm going to forget these three men here, my girl, gone. The minute they see you sick, they go on to check to see who's the benefit on your insurance.
That go both ways,
it does.
No,
it
does.
Yeah, for sure.
Now just excuse your triggers only three.
Yeah.
You're talking to them.
Right.
That's the first thing to do is check to see who's the beneficiary. That's the first thing. They got to know how much is going to be left for them, if any, before they start taking care of you.
It's even worded, yeah.
It's even worded. And if you're in that state where you can make decisions whether you should be go to the state to get treatment, God help you.
So it pays to be aware of these things, not to say that you're
You have the plan. You have the plan for these things. And in this,
don't let it happen
this
to you.
Kind of time.
Because somebody else can always be jumping stick on you. You
yeah.
make sure.
Make
you
decisions
got your
for you.
Covered.
They make decisions. Well, why she have to have chemo for a year? 3 months, she could be dead.
Wow.
Why spend all of this money? For what?
Yeah,
they make that decision. Why I gotta wait a year and a half to get that money? She leaving for me $500,000 and I could get that in 3 months.
And I guess BC coming right now.
Yeah, and all these kind of things. So, I mean, she's prolonging this.
Yeah.
Cut that
suffering.
Short. Cut that suffering short.
You spend time with her for them 3 months?
Yeah. So it's not a death. We just call it suicide, assisted death.
No.
You just stop the treatment. Because it's inevitable. Okay? So in order for a will to be revoked, the testator, of course, has to be 18. Of course, you know, it has to be 18 in order to execute a will, and it must have the capacity to revoke the will. And note that exception for marriage, a change in circumstances after the will has been executed, does not revoke a will.
So with the exception of marriage, what other change in circumstance would they be talking about?
The will may be revoked by a
will.
What do you call it, a codicil?
It's like a little
amendment.
Yeah.
Or by another document, by destruction, or by marriage.
By the will being destroyed, it's no longer in existence.
There's a procedure for destruction.
Oh, you actually
not
get rid of it, like the lawyer shreds it or something?
No, it's, you have to have intention. I can't say, now listen here, Edgar, I tied to you, you know, and I put you in this will. I ain't giving you nothing.
And tear it up.
That's an angle. Will still valid.
Even though you don't have a copy of it?
It's valid. You have a copy. Someone else may have a copy.
So you have a copy.
If you write a will and we're married and we get divorced,
that's
the will is
that's the thing I'm
here. You write a new will.
Okay.
You can alter a will. Alterations made before the execution is valid. If the testator intends the alteration to form a part of the will. If the alteration is made after, it has to actually follow the formalities under the Wills Act. It has to be witnessed. So intestate, when a person dies, it is important to ascertain whether that person made a valid will before his death. And the rules of intestacy provide that when a person dies intestate, his property will pass to his personal representative, who will hold it upon trust for those beneficiaries entitled. And if there's no valid will, the disposition will be determined by the intestacy rules. And the intestacy rules is in the Inheritance Act, and they explain who is entitled after you paid all debts, expenses, and taxes. So you could do it two ways. You could either say who you wanted to go to, or you could let the law or the land determine. So there's what we call total or partial intestacy. Total intestacy applies if the deceased made no will at all, or he made an invalid will, or revoked any wills he has made, or he made a will that did not effectively dispose of his property. And partial intestacy applies if the deceased left the will, but the will disposes of only part of his estate. So when a person dies intestate, you have to be able to identify who are the surviving relatives. Then you have to ask whether they died with a surviving spouse. And if a decree of divorce has been pronounced before the intestate death, then the spouse is not a surviving spouse for those purposes. Because you know, some people do die before they get the actual decree. Okay. So that means the person is still their spouse. So under the rules of intestacy in the Bahamas, if an intestate leaves a husband or wife and no surviving children, the surviving husband or wife shall take the whole residuary estate. Take everything.
Now, when you say residuary estate, that's the house.
No, residuary means after you pay taxes and debts,
oh,
they take
that's
everything
else. Okay, not as well.
If he leaves a husband or wife and one child, the surviving spouse takes half, and the child takes the other half. Okay? If he leaves children, the surviving husband or wife shall take one half, and the remainder is shared equally between the other children.
All.
Yes,
all. Legitimate and illegitimate. All. Special rights applying to spouses. If the deceased is survived by a spouse and issue, then the spouse is entitled to a life interest in half of the residue of the estate. Notice what it said, life interest. If the wife, child, or any persons or child of the deceased being incapacitated by reason of a physical or mental disability that renders him incapable of maintaining himself, any person who in the case, any person not being a child of the deceased, who in the case of any marriage to which deceased was at any time a party, was treated by the deceased as a child of the family, may apply to the court for on the ground that the disposition of the deceased estate affected by his will is not such as to make reasonable provision, financial provision for that.
Going back to if the deceased is survived by a spouse and issue, I understand that the spouse is entitled to life interest and half of the residue. Once they pass, where does that go? They don't make provisions for that. Does that go to the one child, that surviving child?
You mean if they died intestate?
No, let's say I pass as my spouse. He has
life interest.
He can live here in the house until
he does.
And then does that pass to our child?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, automatically. He can't make provisions for that and say, well, this goes someplace else.
It depends.
Okay, so that's why it's important to write that will.
Yes.
Make sure he don't.
Mm-hmm.
Or her.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes.
So those marriages that are...
marriage again. There's only one marriage. There's only one marriage.
Those marriages where, you know, name is... you know, getting married, the person so that they can get status here in the country.
Mm-hmm.
Those persons are entitled to the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
How do you go
about legal marriage?
Disproving that? I know because I don't find the words, and she tell me, and I mean, right now it's investigating
cases like that.
Yeah. Because they're coming there and they're claiming.
Yeah.
And
but they have a right to.
Especially if you go and you marry them, then that's what you give them.
That's what you give them. A right. What's his name still married to that woman?
Who's
that? Who died? Frank Anna.
Oh, the Cuban lady?
Yeah.
I don't know.
I think he was still married though.
I don't know.
Well,
I mean, if
she's yes, exactly.
Yeah.
She will be back soon because her son died.
Oh, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
His
other
didn't say that. I think he had a daughter after that.
But then there's a clause of abandonment anyway.
Who says she abandoned her?
He just called me.
She went.
She just went away. I used to establish a business, went to visit family. Well, what about abandonment? Abandonment is after a certain number of years, you know.
Yeah.
Know
and then you start the process for divorce.
Mm-hmm.
So if he never filed,
yeah.
or started the process for divorce, then how can you claim abandonment? He was well aware of what I was doing over there.
So let's say his children were alive or whatever. They can't.
I think he has a daughter.
Yeah. She yes. can't. Let's say if this woman comes back, she can't.
He never written the will.
But
now you see
be,
how it becomes contentious?
Will, wouldn't she have 50% as a spouse? No way.
No, she was on a matrimonial home. She doesn't live here.
Oh, okay. She
they're not in there. She's been gone for what?
So what would she
four,
be
four years, 5 years?
Sure.
If he died without a will,
mm-hmm.
she's entitled. The half.
Yes, I was about to say the half, but any more being talked about.
Yeah, she's entitled to half.
So
they're legally married.
If he
died without a will.
If he didn't have a will.
All right.
Mm-hmm. Even though she left.
Mm-hmm. But then again, let's say he left a will,
mm-hmm.
and he made no provisions for her, but he
she
was sending her money every month.
She can contest,
she can,
yes,
yes, she can contest it for financial provisions.
So that's why we need to stop taking the courts and make sure that we take care of our...
The law is there.
Yeah.
You have to take, you know, you have to take advantage of it.
Yeah, the law is there. So you have to read the law when you don't understand and seek an attorney for whatever it is you want to do to protect yourself. Couldn't find a black man.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I thought you were
white.
I'm surprised. That's a
refreshing
time.
That's where you're trying to change from one to the other.
Nothing wrong with that.
So obtaining a grant. After the testator's death, the personal representative will need to prove the testator's will, prepare the appropriate oath form, prepare the relevant inland revenue account, administer the estate. I put inland revenue account because, you know, even now we're moving towards
that.
Even though we don't have inheritance tax, this person has a business. They have to make sure that all of their inland revenue account is in order. Okay? They will prepare their estate account showing that the estate has been distributed to the beneficiaries and that the administration is complete.
And what is this appropriate old form?
It's an actual form where they have to swear that all of the what they've represented is true.
Mm-hmm.
And they've done what they're supposed to do according to the law, which means like seek out all the assets and find out all the beneficiaries. The PR should obtain details of deceased debts. If the deceased had bank accounts, shares, the personal representative must obtain the exact values by writing to the various institutions. So normally you see a letter would come from so-and-so law firm,
mm-hmm.
and they'll put the name of the deceased, and they ask you to actually confirm whether the deceased had any accounts with the bank. The personal representative will need to establish the identity of the beneficiaries and take steps to trace any missing beneficiaries. So sometimes if they say, depends on how the will is worded, when you wrote the will, they say, for all my grandchildren, but my son is living in Germany, they'll actually put an ad in the paper over there for all relatives of that person to
that,
come forward.
The funding for that comes out of
the state, yeah. So what's a grant? It's a court order, and it's evidence of the personal representative titled to deal with the deceased estate. The probate business can be non-contentious, what we call a common form, or it can be contentious, which is solemn form. A grant is made by the Bahamian courts where the deceased left property situated in the Bahamas, and the personal representative acting for the deceased estate will normally obtain one of the following grants: either probate, that's when he died with the will, or letters of administration with the will annexed, that's when the will has a defect in it, or letters of administration, just died with the will. If there is a will, this will need to be obtained, and its validity and admissibility to probate has to be considered.
Another thing I was wondering, when you say, when you are probating a will, or you have your, you know, the administrator's doing what needs to be done, debts and obligations are taken care of first.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say, for example, this person had some property which, once those obligations are met, will be distributed equally among the children.
Mm-hmm.
Can one of those, or all the children can say, well, okay, these are my father's debts or my mother's debts. We will pay them all.
Mm-hmm.
And then just let that continue. Then they'll say, okay, well, that's dealt with.
Mm-hmm.
Then you can go and distribute. Okay.
Sometimes if someone will write a will where, let's say they have a mortgage and the mortgage is behind, they can stipulate whether or not the arrears come from the estate or the person that they will it to
can
must pay
it. Okay.
So basically, you can do anything you say it you want.
If a, so let's say, you know, the deceased and the remaining spouse and children and whomever, if there's a challenge or if they're coming forward and the person who's leading that challenge, let's say they die, they pass away, what happens after that?
Gone?
Is it,
just
yeah.
gone.
Mm-hmm.
Just the challenge, it just disappears. Because
who's
going to
challenge it?
Why would you want to do that? Because if he delivered me something, he didn't pay the mortgage on it and say, and you must pay. I mean, just
then it goes into residuary.
Okay.
And if you're one of those that are in the residuary pool, you still get it.
Yeah.
So people that actually leave you debt.
Yes.
That's probably why you have insurance, because most banks now, if you have a mortgage, you have a life insurance, so once you die.
And
then
in
the
some
bank,
instances where people get loans that the bank offer you an insurance, for those small loans, they don't take it.
Oh, yes, but nominal fee to it.
They don't want it. So you still end up in more debt to come out of the estate.
Right.
So all of these are things you have to think about when you make all of these arrangements. What if I die? What's going to be left? Okay, so the effect of the grant differs between executors and administrators. Like I said, executor, he can begin immediately. He doesn't need the court to say he can begin to act. But for the administrator, he has no authority until the grant is obtained. So normally when people come to the bank, they say so-and-so just died. They need the burial. They want to withdraw $10,000. That can't happen.
Who starts that process? It'll be a family member getting that.
Can be a family member, or it can be an actual personal representative.
Okay.
If there's a will, there's an executor. They'll bring the will with them. If there's no will, then it's a family member.
Yeah. Okay.
And the law allows you how much to take off the account?
$2,500.
Okay.
That's
the
executor.
No, that's one executor. $2,500. That's all you can take off the bank account.
Well, we don't give that.
No, it goes straight
just
to
the
funeral. To the funeral home. So it's $2,500. Average cost of a funeral is?
About
$10,000. That's where they start. Unless you cremate, it's five. So go that way.
That makes sense.
Save more money.
It's true. I mean,
but realize now, when someone dies and you put your foot forward to organize and you sign that paper with the funeral home, don't look to me. They help you bear
because you're liable.
You're liable. Wow.
That's why.
That's why always when people come to me and they say someone that is like, "Oh, I'm going to make the arrangements."
Right.
And when you sign that, you're liable.
Yeah.
Don't come back looking to the brothers and sisters to pay, because I can tell you, I didn't tell you to buy that.
That costs a lot.
That's $30,000. Who you didn't pay? Oh, I thought we could split it between us. No, no. You sign that, you pay for it. Hold on now. I know of an instance where. The mother died, and the son signed for the funeral arrangements.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, in the heat of the moment. Not realizing that the mother had always said she left the insurance to him.
But it wasn't to him.
It was not to him.
No.
It was to his sister.
And she didn't give me the insurance money to pay for the
funeral. No, she said no.
Wow.
So why would the sister do that?
I'm not giving you my money. You went to this elaborate funeral.
They don't have to be elaborate though, that's the thing.
Yeah.
No, but they thought that the insurance was theirs.
No, you can't.
The mother always
said
the insurance. This person actually took care of their mother.
Wow.
Every time she called, she needed money,
the
gave it to her. Mm-hmm.
See, but then you can't.
Well,
you're not supposed to be
doing that.
You can't be doing that on the
yeah.
strength of when she dies, she left us. You got to do that because I'm doing this for my mother. She don't give it up, and then that's fine. But you still have to know. If it ain't written, don't go saying, oh, the best coffin for her. You got to know what you can afford. Tell someone else, say.
He planned an elaborate.
Yeah, for his mother. I love his mother so much.
Full body move.
Wow. was a main sister.
But we see it all the time.
She said, well, you say let the bed.
You see it all the time.
You can show good money as well.
I just had to deal with that situation.
I don't believe
yesterday,
an expensive coffin.
The son came in with the mother, and we had to remove him because he was like,
the sister took all the money off the account.
The mother's elderly, she's ill, and she had the money there to not just pay her bills, but like he said, her funeral and all the arrangements, and the sister,
she was a giant.
She put on the account.
Took all the money.
Oh my
right.
God.
Mm-hmm. So we didn't, and he was just sent. And we were like, the moment, because you were asking the questions, so we can't answer the questions because you're not on the account, so I can't.
Yeah, we can give it to the mother.
Right, so we have to bring the mother aside. But he was like, I'm the one who take my mother to the doctor. I'm the one who make sure she's.
And that's what the parents
mother,
do.
You know,
you're the one who's doing everything, but they give someone else the signing authority who takes all the money. And I tell them in the glass that they take the money. You have to sue them.
So, he's left like, what do
you, I mean, do you want to go and sue your sister?
Yeah.
Yes. Hey, foreigners do it every day.
Exactly.
Well,
they don't blame.
Think about it. The sister took your mother's money, and you have proof that only your pension goes there.
So now there's no money to bury her.
There's no money.
She took the money.
You just see the process going, and she has the right to do it.
Oh, you just cremate mom.
She's signing on
to look, I can afford to cremate.
So that's $5,000. She said the account is empty.
It is.
So how are you going to do it? And she's still a signatory on the account.
Wow.
And only mommy can move it.
Isn't that why they create accounts where a person's only able to put in and not take off, or they don't do that?
No,
no, no.
Not set up like that.
No, you're not set up like that.
Yeah.
But this, see, that is why you see those old people in front of the bank at the end of the month. They let no one is left for them. So better they take 50 hours to get in line, they go in for the same reason.
Yeah, we had a situation, a lady, another customer, and she's like, I don't know what to do, because she's here, that she didn't have any children, and her sister, she's like, but if I put this person on, they're going to take, and it's like she didn't know who to trust, and I just,
yeah.
And she's like, what do I do, and we can't tell you what to do, you have to make this decision.
Right.
You know.
Wow.
It's really, really bad. But then to pay, you know,
the fees. So, we mentioned this already, the duties and responsibility of a personal representative, whether they're an executive or administrator.
What about this, on the previous,
mm-hmm.
did I see that? The facts of run difference between executives and administrators, have we gotten there?
Yeah,
we
do.
What about this one that says a maximum of something persons
can
apply?
That's what you find out.
Huh? You find that out?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, a maximum of something
last
person
can
apply.
Maximum person
okay.
Can apply.
Oh, yeah.
They all.
Okay, well, there you go.
So a person representative, you know, they have to collect the deceased estate. They have to take reasonable steps to collect them on any money that is due to the deceased. They have to pay the funeral and testamentary expenses, any debts, distribute the legacies, and to complete the whole residual estates. A personal representative are personally liable for loss to the estate resulting from any breach of duty they commit as the personal representative. The breach of duty can occur where there is an omission to safeguard the assets. Remember, I give an example like a business.
Mm-hmm.
Maladministration, making bad and poor decisions. Misappropriation of assets. Breach of a statutory duty of care.
So not anybody can do this then? You need to have certain...
You don't need qualifications.
No,
but
an awareness of your responsibility in terms of...
So this whole slide here, you will see when we do trust, it leans into... the law of trust.
Yeah, because I'm even talking, I think.
Because you have
prudent,
an obligation, and you have to be prudent.
Yeah.
Yes.
Exactly.
And you have to be honest.
Yeah.
Okay? And of course, it says he's liable for his acts or omissions.
So it's best then to hire a lawyer if you don't know anything about it.
Well, normally what you do is you write a will, you appoint someone as an executor, and you give it to an attorney to execute.
Mm-hmm.
So the attorney would do all of that. The only thing you would probably do is then they come to you as an executive for decisions. Or you would follow with the attorney to make sure everything is being done and all the filings are done to the court. But they do all of the rest. Obtaining a grant, personal representative has the power to employ agents. They can delegate by power of attorney. They have the power of sale, power to appoint trustees, power to postpone distribution, and you'll see all of these powers are similar to what a trustee actually has when he manages a trust. So when you become a personal representative, you take on that obligation like a trustee. You are put in trust with the deceased assets, and then you have a duty to carry out these actions. Personal representatives are in a fiduciary position and must act with the utmost good faith in relation to the estate. So the only persons entitled to apply for a grant of probate are the executors who have been expressly nominated in the will or impliedly nominated. An executor's appointment may be implied where the will shows an intention that a particular person should form the activities. For example, the collection of the deceased debt. So let's say in the will, in the first paragraph, the deceased did not appoint an executor. But you see on page 2 and 3, where he says, Leroy should collect all of my money. Leroy should pay my bill. The based upon the activities which Leroy. Fall under the duties of a personal representative, that person will be appointed to take care of the deceased estate. The executors may be appointed where the will appoints someone to nominate an executor, or where the court has power to appoint a substitute executor. So sometimes you can write a will whereby you say, I hereby leave my daughter Sandra to appoint a person as an executor. Then that person appoints who they want.
Can they say the 250 total? Like how you said, witnesses can be a part of the beneficiaries. Right? Those who witness can be a beneficiary, correct?
No.
So if they say, if one of the witnesses is Sandra, can you say, he appoints Sandra to be a, I mean, to find a,
the final executor. Letters of administration with will annex, an application for this grant is appropriate where there is a valid will, but it's not possible to make a grant of probate in favor of the executor. Example, the executor has not been appointed, the sole executor is a minor, the executor has renounced probate, the executor has died before obtaining the grant, or the executor has failed to appear to a citation, or the executor has been passed over by order of the court. Before a passover, when someone is not fit and proper to be an executor, you can challenge them. Apply to the court to have them passed over. Letters of administration and grant obtained where there is no valid will. So there are different types of grants you can get to the court. You can get a grant limited to time. This is where the will states that executor is only to act during the infancy of my son or my daughter. You can have a grant limited to purpose. So you can apply to the court and say, I want a grant just to deal with these orders for the shop. Or if it's litigation, if the person was in court and you want to finish that matter, you can get a grant just for that purpose. Grants limited as to property, executors may be appointed to deal only with a particular property. Or administration concerning not administered good. This is what you call a grant de bonis non. The grant is required to complete the administration of the deceased estate following the death of the sole or last surviving personal representative. So let me explain that to you. If I wrote a will and I said Mary is my executor, Mary dies before she's finished administering my will. The executor and her will has to take over the responsibility of the first one. And it moves like that. So say if Mary dies, she appointed Sandra. Before Sandra was able to finish the administration of my will, she died. She had appointed Leroy as her executor. Leroy has to do both. If Leroy dies before he finished administering that one, whoever's in the next one has to do all. That's how it's done. Okay, it's a chain.
So, and then if the person doesn't have a will, one of the subsequent people,
then the chain is broken.
Then
the chain is broken.
And then it's just free for all. Like
no, you're no free for all. No.
Before I go back to the phone, that person
did. Apply for the bonus loan. Someone come forward to complete it. And that's happened in a lot of here locally, some wealthy people. When the chain is broken and it's going further down the line to finish it. So David appoints Sam to be the executor, like I said, and Sam approved David's will, but dies before the administration is complete. And Sam was appointed Leslie as the executor. Leslie approved Sam's will, and by doing so, automatically become the executor of David. That's how it works. Would you say no one must appoint you? And so that whole thing is called the chain of representation. That's the process. process. I'm so sorry, Miguel, to forget all of you. So what if Leslie has renounced before taking the grant? And what if Leslie had died before taking the grant? And what if Sam died in intestate? There would have been no chain, and a grant of the bonus none would have been needed to complete Davis's grant, like it just said.
Okay,
here's
the beginning. Mm-hmm.
Affidavits, renunciations, and replication. Affidavit evidence, the registrar may require further evidence, for example, an affidavit of due execution where there is no attestation clause or there are doubtful circumstances about the execution of the will. So say you wrote the will and the attestation is the very bottom where the witnesses attest that they witnessed this will.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it depends on the wording or the way in which it was signed. The court will actually have a form that you fill out called an affidavit of due execution, where you swear that you witnessed this will. A caveat, this is a notice entered at any probate registry to prevent the issue of a grant of representation. So say someone has written a will, or they have put in four letters of administration, and you want to stop the process. You put in a caveat. So at the registry, there is a book, and it's just for caveats. A caveat may be used when a beneficiary believes that the executive name in the will lacks the necessary mental capacity, or the validity of the will is questioned. So let's just say someone died, the family has applied for probate, the executive has applied for probate, and you believe that that will is fraudulent. You can go to the court and apply for a caveat. Stop it so you can challenge it. A citation, these are documents issued by the probate registry. They're used to give remedy where a person initially entitled to take the grant refuses to renounce. And for example, a citation to accept or refuse a grant will be issued to clear off a person who has a right to take out the grant but is not interested in doing it. So let's just say if you're applying for a grant, which means you're going under letters of administration, the person died intestate or the will was invalid. So clear off means you have to go to order of priority in terms of familial relations. So let's just say the first person in the family would be, let's say the oldest person in the family is sister. And she say, I don't want to do it.
Mm-hmm.
That's called clearing off.
Okay.
You clear off that person. Then you go to the next one in line.
This citation clears that person off?
This is what the order is. It's called a citation.
Okay.
You clear
okay.
them off.
Okay.
The other one is when the person represented doesn't want to do it. That's called a renunciation.
Right.
And that's what we call passing over.
Okay,
it's like
yes.
pass it over you. The other one is when you look at familiar relations and you clear them off. Renunciation. A person who's entitled to a grant of representation may renounce his entitlement unless he has lost the right to renounce. An executive loses his right to renounce if he intermeddles in the estate. So you have some people who they're not the executor, they're not the administrator, but they go around pretending that they are.
Mm.
See, so the person dies, they all about knocking on the people's door. I'm so daddy. I'm just collect the rent. So I'm coming every month to collect the rent. People do that. They start assuming these responsibilities. You see? The family can take them to court as saying that they're intermeddling in the affairs. And they can actually, you can lose your rights. Because remember now, as an administrator, you cannot begin until the court grants you that right. A potential administrator does not lose his right to renounce if he intermeddles. But he has to be a potential administrator. A renunciation can be retracted by order of the registrar. Revocation of grants. Revocation of a grant normally occurs where the person to whom the grant was made was not entitled. Where a person thought to be a predeceased is subsequently found to be alive and is better entitled to the grant. You understand that?
Yes.
They can revoke the grant.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Or where the grant was made despite the entry of a caveat.
So that's a good result.
Where a fraudulent application was made by a person with no right to the grant. where a grant was made even though contentious probate proceedings were pending, or where a subsequent will is discovered. All of these can revoke a grant, or where the will is found to be invalid after a grant, or where the person representative becomes mentally or physically incapable or disappears, or he just wishes to retire. But all these grounds, a grant can be revoked. So passing over, the court will permit passing over the person entitled to the grant if it appears to be necessary or expedient to appoint as administrator some person other than the person entitled to take a grant. And when the court exercises this power, it can appoint anyone. So this occurs where the person entitled requests the appointment of a nominee, or the person entitled is unsuitable for that office, or the executor is in prison, or when an executor has dealt with estate property without taking out a grant.
Which they should not have done.
Mm-hmm. And you have what you call an executor disentor. It means an executor, as a result of his own wrong, intermeddles with the estate as if he were an executor or administrator. And intermeddling means he starts selling property, paying debts, collecting debts, and carrying on the business of the deceased as if he is the deceased, and he's entitled to do so. So acts not amounting to intermeddling, acts of charity, acts of humanity, and acts of necessity.
And when you say acts of charity that don't amount to intermeddling, meaning what? You give something on behalf of the deceased?
Mm-hmm.
From your own assets?
From the deceased.
So you can do that?
So I could give an example. Say a wife.
Why do you always say a husband?
Okay, a husband's wife.
He's the one.
No, husband. A husband.
Okay. I have to say it like this so I can.
Why?
Yes.
Okay,
right.
Okay then.
So say a husband dies and he leaves an executor who's not the wife. But maybe he had a joint account with the wife, or maybe she had some kind of silent authority on the account. But in the same way that she's not entitled to the actual funds on the account that we spoke of earlier, right?
Mm-hmm.
Following me so far?
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's say they have people who worked for them, and before the executors or executive could have, I guess, continued paying the salaries or whatever, she took it upon herself maybe to pay them off, like say they didn't need them anymore, and she started paying them like retirement or whatever it is. Is that considered?
That's a charity.
What about necessity? Or
necessity is when someone is in dire need.
So she would have been intermeddling per se to take it upon herself to use those funds.
Yeah.
Or for example, she says, now we need a new fridge, I need to fix the roof, and all this stuff, and she just starts spending money as an example. Let's say.
Yeah, no, she can't do that. That's a mere necessity. What's a necessity? In dire need.
I don't pay a medical bill?
Depends. Maybe a deposit to have a procedure done.
Yeah.
Not an outstanding bill. That's not a necessity.
Mm-hmm. What about an act of charity, though? What would you be doing?
I don't know. Let's take the hurricane.
And you figured you'd give somebody
money? Give some money, yeah.
Same thing with the acts of humanity, I guess. Right?
Yeah. But you can't go around and start selling property and collecting debt if you're not a potential administrator.
So the lawyer who was advising the executive could make them aware that?
They normally don't.
Oh.
They normally don't. They don't sit down and tell you, you are the executive. This is what you should do.
No, I mean, but if they are aware of intermeddling.
Who, the lawyer?
Yeah.
They should.
Okay.
It's the law that goes with it.
Mm-hmm.
If they studied it. They may just say that we just act. Okay? So the effect of being an executive disentor is that you become liable to the creditors and beneficiaries, to the extent of the real and personal estate coming into your hands as if you actually were an executor. So you become liable. An executive disentor can bring his liability to creditors and beneficiaries to an end by giving the assets he has received or their value to the lawful executor or administrator before the creditors or beneficiaries bring an action against him. So let's talk about death and taxes. So what to do about tax and benefits after death? After death, there's a lot to manage at a distressing time. However, it's important to deal with tax and benefit affairs as soon as you can, so that you can receive any money you're entitled to and pay any taxes on time. And sometimes time scales are short. Those people like Miguel, they bury you in 1 week. Why is that? Why do you bury people like Miguel Lewis in 1 week?
He looking out to see.
Yeah.
You don't know why?
They no.
Planning.
Because they can't shoot gas to get the land buried.
No. I'm not doing none of that. They turn black.
Oh.
That's true.
Oh. Well, that sounds like, you know, that a week is a long time, because I remember when I was in Costa Rica.
So they do 2-3 days on the same day?
Yes, I was there. I was there. You remember when Charles Carter's
no, they turn black.
Yeah, they turn black. Charles Carter's
turned black.
He died. He was killed. That's the one who got killed in Miami. Some mysterious murder in this gated community.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was telling the lady that I was staying with. I said, oh, I heard about this death. And the funeral is going to be, let's say I was talking to like on a Sunday. And I said, they probably have the funeral on Saturday. When I said that, she started to scream. And I was like, oh, God, what happened? And she said, a whole week. In Costa Rica, if you die that morning, they put you in the ground in the afternoon. And they have a memorial service.
Mm-hmm.
But they don't go through that whole cremation and no. You die this morning, they can try to bury that day.
That's
and then
they also don't
get
the
family, right.
So they don't
the family will get together later on, probably
right.
In a week and have a memorial. But they don't keep the body hanging on.
Body burn it.
You don't want to
burn
a funeral and sell themselves.
Yeah.
What happened again? You know,
just
burn it. Not burn you. Okay, so we talked about this before. You know, once a person dies, there's survivor's benefits. Payment is made monthly, and I think there are some stipulations because my aunt was unable to get hers because she was still working.
Survivor's benefit. And how long does that go on for?
I don't know how long that goes on for.
And obviously it's conditional.
Yeah, they ask some conditions. They're saying that she was making too much money. She was a retiree.
Survivor's benefit.
Yeah.
Yeah, I saw I think it was $1,700 and some dollars.
A month?
No, 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 no. We was at National Insurance the other day.
Yeah, and they keep changing.
Burial sum is $1,780.
What
they
give you?
Yeah.
See, survivor's benefit is paid to survivor dependents and the foreign priority order. The children under 16, any unmarried orphans, unmarried children, who are not children of the deceased, but who are dependent upon him or her, or the parents.
I thought it was under 18.
The parents.
I thought it was 18. No,
dependent children?
Well, under 21, if still at school full time.
My sister, her husband died, and when he died, his son was, I think he was 17, and she was getting benefit for him, because they said it was under...
Or under 18. 21 is still
okay.
In school
full
time.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Survivor's benefit is not awarded to a widow if the marriage of the deceased took place after the deceased was awarded retirement or invalidity benefit. Payment of survivor's benefit to a widow ceases if he or she remarries or cohabits. They don't call it sweetheart, it's called cohabitation. Yes, cohabits. So all unmarried orphans who were dependent on the deceased insured person at the time of his or her death are entitled to survivor's benefit if they were children of the deceased, younger than 16 or 21 if they're still in school, receiving full education or training for which they are not being paid, and they were either living with or maintained by the deceased. The minimum payment is 133.25. Now, that's minimum payment. Notice the recent article in the paper where the government now has to increase your benefits. Otherwise, the plan will not. How are they going to either dissolve it or increase the benefits?
Increase the
contribution.
Yeah.
Or decrease
but
the benefits.
They just increase
national insurance.
That's
but it's not enough to sustain it.
Yeah, that's normal.
We know that part, but you all won't protest.
What did she say?
You go to Ross and protest, you know, it's a scorching for Ross and Square. So you can't go to Ross and Square and protest.
Mm-hmm.
am I ready to retire?
What time are you retiring? What
I'm saying.
Give me a number.
Next 30 years.
30? What is this? Oh, no money.
Yeah.
In a day.
In a money. In a money.
It'll just be.
Thank God I get mine. I saw it yours. I get mine.
Next 20 years, I'll be here.
That's 20 years?
No.
As they build more affordable homes, your money is going. That's where the money goes. They're building homes worth what? 50,000, 90,000? That's where your money goes. There won't be any benefits for you. I look at y'all now and Okay, there are new stocks. You have gift, wealth, estate, and
all that
kind of
stuff. You better leave some of that for us then.
No, no, I didn't get all my money.
Let me get you on record and tell these people I'm like the sun.
Are there any gifts, wealth, estate, and or inheritance taxes in the Bahamas?
None?
Mm-hmm.
Ain't you all lucky?
Not after you don't comment you made before this. This can't be the silver lining.
So what is inheritance tax? Inheritance tax is usually paid on an estate when somebody dies. Payable on trusts or gifts made during someone's lifetime. Most estates don't have to pay inheritance tax because they're valued at less than the threshold. And in the United Kingdom, that threshold is $325,000. The tax is payable at 40% on the amount over this threshold or 36% if you donate to charity. 40%. Now,
sorry,
question.
Is this tax paid prior to paying your debtors? Sorry, your creditors?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, it's
before.
Before.
Yeah, you gotta pay your tax. Tax first. You gotta pay tax. Now, when you go home.
Offshore banking was so profitable.
When you go home, you will see there's a document from Ernst & Young that speaks about inheritance tax around the world, like I mentioned. And I just have an example of three countries here. And you would see the threshold and the percentages are different. Depends on where you are. So wealthy people use these to see where to put their money. Again, aren't you happy to be in the Bahamas?
Kind of. See, to be on the pension.
No, but we will be moving to this with the Department of Inland Revenue. We have to eventually. You have to move to all forms of taxation to sustain this economy.
Yeah.
Whether we like it or not,
yeah,
I'll be gone.
That's why I have no pension now.
You all have to look for this.
It all depends on the threshold.
Huh? I guess it all depends on the threshold exactly.
Yeah.
But you can get paid something though.
You get to pay something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's no stamp tax. And
you won't avoid it.
Transactions and
like that. For us?
Yeah.
No.
No. Okay.
Only you'll actually pay is if you buy a loan.
Okay.
Yeah. Just in legal fees. So who is responsible for paying inheritance tax? Inheritance tax is payable by different people in different circumstances. Normally, it's the executor or the personal representative pays it using funds from the deceased estate. The trustees are usually responsible for paying inheritance tax on assets in or transferred into a trust. Sometimes people who have received gifts or who inherit from the deceased have to pay inheritance tax, but this is not common.
Because that almost be like double taxation.
Mm-hmm. So inheritance tax is only paid if the value of the deceased estate or transfer in connection with a trust exceeds $325,000. Now, $325,000,
I guess
it's still in effect. Yeah, it changes.
Okay.
It's still in effect, but 2017 is going to change. The executor or the person representative usually pays the tax from the deceased estate, that's what he works. The trustee usually pays it from the
trust
assets. So when does the executor pay? Usually the executor, person representative, pays inheritance tax on any assets in the deceased estate that are not held in trust. And the money generally comes from the deceased person's estate. However, because the tax must be paid within 6 months of the death and before the grant of probate can be issued, that's how it works. Sometimes the executor has to borrow the money or pay it from their own funds.
Wow.
And this can happen if it hasn't been possible to get the money from the estate in time because it's tied up in assets that have to be sold.
Mm.
In these cases, the executor or the people who have advanced the money can be reimbursed from the estate before it's distributed among the beneficiaries.
And I guess there are penalties if it's not paid within 6 months.
Mm-hmm.
But it must be hefty if you borrow to pay them.
Mm. So inheritance tax on transfers into trust is only necessary if the total transfer amount is above the inheritance tax threshold and is usually payable by the person making the transfer, known as the settlor, not the trustee. The trustees must pay any inheritance tax due on land or assets already held in trust. And the occasions for this include transfers out of the trust and every 10 years after the original transfer into the trust, that's known as the 10-year anniversary charge.
So you would pay
now, and you have to pay 10 years after.
You want the so the value of that time you
mm-hmm.
pay.
And then you pay it 10 years again, because it's 10-year anniversary.
So that once the trust is dissolved, you don't owe anything?
No.
Okay.
But as it goes on, you have to pay.
That's
have anniversaries. Yeah.
Every 10 years.
When the beneficiary of the trust, known as the life tenant, dies, interest in possession, trust only. So when does a beneficiary or a donee has to pay inheritance tax? If the executor or the trustees can't pay the inheritance tax, the beneficiaries or the donees have to pay it.
Mm-hmm.
A beneficiary or donee only has to pay inheritance tax in this case if they receive a share of an estate after a death, or they receive a gift from someone who dies within 7 years of making the gift. So in England, if I give you a gift, right? And I die 4 years after, you have to pay tax on it.
On whatever amount I got.
Mm-hmm. It has to be 7 years.
This is coming from a trust, though.
Oh, no, it could be any gift. A gift has to be within 7 years, otherwise you're taxed.
Mm-hmm. Gee, okay, so I'm going, think of doing a degree or something like that, and my
I
English godmother say, oh yeah,
$50,000
towards
mm-hmm.
that, you take care of this. And then I kick the bucket.
Not you.
Oh. Them, yeah.
Uh-huh.
That's my whole percentage is now.
Big tax, yeah. That's to be 7 years after the gift was granted.
Okay.
What if there's nothing
inheritance
left? What if there's nothing left of the gift?
Mm-hmm.
It's not like
mm-hmm.
you're still liable.
What if there's nothing left of the gift?
What do I have to do with it?
If you use all the $50,000 in the middle of the year.
The threshold don't work like that. The threshold is on the deceased. That's it. You can see in a minute. Yeah.
Yeah.
So you have to make provisions for that, I guess.
But
and
you
have to
sell
it. No, but I'm thinking that's what you'd probably have to do. Say, okay, let me set this
aside.
And,
aside,
and,
the person
and after 7 years,
that.
I know I'm free and clear. I don't
yeah.
give this to me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But we'll get there someone. You
well,
you
had that $50,000 from the get-go, so if you give yourself 40 outside of 10 to cover that.
And you got to do something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you got to
buy
that 10 or whatever it is.
So now you see why those people in the States, especially the black people, always go into co-op for not paying taxes.
Taxes,
yeah. That's nice. No, think about it. You make all this money, and then they take all of it back.
Mm-hmm.
Like
Wesley Snipes was like that.
Yeah.
That bad little girl too. No, it wasn't ours.
Lauren.
Yeah.
Very
taxes.
Okay, if they're joint owners other than a spouse or a civil partner of a property. If someone gives you a gift and they do not survive for 7 years after making the gift, you would only be liable to pay the inheritance tax on that gift if the value of the estate, including the gift, is over the inheritance tax threshold of 325. That's the question you're asking, right?
Oh, and,
and there is not enough money in the estate to pay the inheritance tax.
So you might be clear if they can afford to pay it.
If they can't, you have to pay it.
Yeah.
And it depends on the threshold. However, if all the gifts made by that person during the 7 years before they died add up to more than inheritance tax threshold, just the gifts themselves, not the rest of the estate, inheritance tax would be due on all of the gifts that brought the total above the threshold.
So what was the differences?
In this case,
how do you determine the gifts that brought it above? Would you really say the gifts that brought it above the threshold?
By date?
Oh, by date. Oh, okay, okay.
In the case you as the donor, you will usually have to pay the tax due on your gift.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want no gifts.
Mm-hmm.
So someone dies and they own property as joint tenants with you, but you are not their spouse or civil partner. Inheritance tax will be payable on their share of the joint property if the value, again, is over the threshold. As the surviving joint owner, you will be responsible for paying the inheritance tax. If the deceased said in their will that joint property held as tenants in common should be given free of tax, inheritance tax will come from the rest of their estate. If there is enough money in the estate to pay the taxes. If there isn't, you have to pay the difference. So recovering your money, if you paid inheritance tax for someone else, you're entitled to claim the money back from the estate or from whoever should have paid the inheritance tax. And you can do this once probate has been granted before the estate is distributed among the beneficiaries.
See how easy this is? You don't get nothing back from the tax people, I see. You gotta go back.
Oh, no, you don't get nothing from the tax people. Take over there. So someone tell me.
What this is?
Put on your eyes. And since Miguel has been missing for most of the class, we'll let him do this one. You we all agree?
That sounds like an idea.
Mm-hmm. And Sherelle, you'll correct him. Yes.
You thought I was going to leave you all day?
No.
Okay, Miguel.
The only thing I can calculate is 10% off the thing.
So that's a start. That's not a start.
£150,000.
Which leaves him a difference of $1,350.
Where you get 10% from?
10% to charity.
He needs 10% to charity.
Oh, you about to. Oh, okay. So that's how you're doing it. Okay, let's see.
And then half the balance to his wife and another half to his children. So are we splitting that $1.35 million then after that?
I don't know. Miguel doing this.
Oh, Miguel doing
this. I am? Really?
Sherelle is assisting you.
Let's talk to Sherelle. Tell me if we're on the right path.
We can be at.
No, we can be at
Sherelle.
Tell
four.
Sherelle helping us.
So we go 10%
right
here again.
We said 10%
is
$150,000.
Half the balance to his wife and then after his children. Which
is.
Is that
36%? Wouldn't somebody be exempt though? That's 325,000 pounds or whatever it is. Isn't there a portion that's exempt or no? You pay it on everything.
It's just that the rate would be different.
Do you do, do you take off the 10% and then you do 36?
Taxes payable 40% on the amount
it's
over this threshold.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Right.
So 36 of the estate qualifies for
it. Or 36% if it's reduced as a result of charitable donation.
Mm-hmm.
So
it's
about
to
take off the charitable.
So
it's 36
on the
first, right? Take it off, you can't get taxed on what you paid charity. So you have to take that off.
$1,500
and
then you
subtract 3.5 and find 36% difference. And what that is? 369. Mm, that ain't sound right.
No. I was on the right track. What did you say you're going to do? And does it make a difference? That sounds like too much or too little.
Well, so the first thing it says, a man with a net estate of 1.5 leaves everything to his wife. And then on to the children on the second death. Means when the wife dies. So she takes it outright.
Initially.
Mm-hmm.
So you would take out your 10% of charity that you've given.
No, she gets it outright.
So she pays.
Oh, she gets that outright. Oh, so we don't even know the word for that charity box that's already been given.
That happens upon her death.
Wow. So the term net estate, because I saw that and I know that has some net estate in this case refers to.
So what happens when she dies? What happens when she dies?
She 40% is paid on.
What you paying the 40% on?
$325,000. Or is it because of the exemption?
No.
Then she only pays the 30%.
When he died, she got her money outright.
Yes.
So he had a tax of $325,000. That's his nil bond.
Okay.
He transferred that to his wife. So when she dies, she gets his nail bond and her nail bond. $650,000.
She would get both.
Mm-hmm. She gets both.
So she would not pay anything on £650,000.
Correct.
Okay. So that's exempt.
Mm-hmm.
But she got this whole 1.5.
Mm-hmm.
So we would take that we would take the 650 from the 1.5.
Ah.
What I don't understand though is they calculate his inheritance tax.
Yeah, because
he has a nil bond. He has
right.
a nil bond. Okay, Sherelle, tell him.
And you pay the 36% on the balance because
mm-hmm.
of the charity.
Exactly.
On £850,000. So 36% of £850,000. People to calculate this?
Can you put it on the board, please? It's beside there.
Mm-hmm. Let's wait for Miguel.
That. Miguel, calculate
47
yeah. £850,000.
Be waiting on you.
I'll be in a minute.
Miguel, it was 40% £850,000.
What's the calculator?
I thought you had one.
Oh, she has one.
I'm still trying to figure out why, if you're calculating his inheritance tax.
You're taking his nail bond.
Why are we still adding her thing upon? That's the problem.
You mean her 325 to
yeah.
his? It passes.
It's 306,000.
Oh, okay.
The tax.
How much?
306. So upon his death,
306. 306. Okay. Because mm? she's getting all the money. The children doesn't get it.
No.
Does she?
She dies.
Okay.
So we're assuming that he doesn't.
This is not
will.
Will.
Mm?
We assume that he doesn't have a will.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay, so he has a voice.
Wow. I had a question, but it was on the exam.
You might as well just throw the towel in right now.
Why?
Because it's missing pertinent information.
Like what?
Like if he died in the state or
yeah.
state. Because I would assume that if someone, I looked at it on the surface, he died and left this money to them. What is the taxable amount?
The tax rate don't change. 40% or 36%. That don't change.
Right.
The 325 doesn't change.
It's just what you, how you apply.
It's just who getting
to.
It. That don't change.
When do we pay this 10% to charity again now? Upon her death or his?
If she got the whole thing outright, then it has to be upon her death.
So we pay that upon her
death. But I'm confused if they say the wife and the other half to his children.
Mm-hmm.
So how does she get it outright if it's on his children?
You mean at the beginning? He leaves everything to his surviving spouse and then on to his children.
It
doesn't
say
that.
That
word.
It's saying and the other half to.
Yeah, I didn't say to leave everything out front to her.
That's why I wasn't including Jessica.
It's a 10% of charity and half of the balance to his wife and the other half to his
children.
It didn't say she would have gotten everything and then. It's sort of tricky.
Nothing is tricky. Nothing is tricky.
Very open to
interpretation. 10% to charity and half. Okay, so if you do this, okay, let me show you. There's two ways you could put this. So if he takes 1.5 and leave 10% to charity, and half of the balance to his wife and other children. How you calculate that? Mm-hmm. Let's go. 10%. So what's 10%?
150,000.
And how much is that?
1.35.
Mm-hmm.
When you divide it in half, gives you 675. And then because of the charitable donation that he made, or see that's what some of this fits in, but if you take 36% of the
from that amount.
And when you take 650,000 from the 1.5.
You mean his nil bond?
Remember you added the wife's 325 exemption plus his 325.
I've done it a different way.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I got confused. I'm like, why? What does she have to do with this equation? If you calculate.
So tell me how you're going to calculate it based upon your wording.
So I would have taken my 675 and subtracted the nil bond, and only the amount above over 325 would have been taxable on his estate. No.
What are you going to do? Minus
50.
No.
No.
We're ready. Actually, no. What I think what I did is I just subtracted 325 from the 1350 outright.
Mm-hmm.
And then I got 1,025,000.
Mm-hmm.
And I found 36% of that. And that's where I got my 369.
Oh, you got 369.
In terms of 36% of that difference.
Mm.
Sherelle?
36%.
Yes? This is made the 369, but I remember when you taught it earlier, you did it the first way we were talking about it in class.
Okay, so now do it this way.
It's 369.
Tell them how you got it.
So I deducted the charitable donation
From the overall
figure.
Okay.
Which is like 1,350,000 when I divided it by two if we're giving half to the wife and children.
Uh-huh.
And then deducting his nil rate ban, assuming that she's taking it out right then and there rather than waiting until she dies. You have 350,000 and then the balance, and if you add all of that and do that, the 36% rate, then yeah, the 369. Mm-hmm.
Okay, can you write that up just so I can see that?
So what the answer?
You subtract from the 350 from
695.
Sherelle,
325
from the 675. Okay, start Sherelle. He left 1.5.
And then you took away the
10%
donation.
Mm-hmm. How much that was?
150.
Mm-hmm.
Which
Lee.
Left you with 1.350.
Uh-huh. And you got a minus this nil bond? How much?
Well, I divided. I took that from the wife's portion. I divided it too, since he left half to the wife.
But see, you cannot take it from
the wife. But you can take it from the whole thing.
Everybody.
Yeah.
So you get 1,025,1025.
1025?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Uh huh.
And then I took 36%.
The 36% itself gives you the 369.
Yeah,
the
same.
Then you did the 36%.
Yeah.
Because he gave to charity. And it come to how much?
369,000.
Now, if the question had asked, how much does the wife have to pay
mm-hmm.
on his death, then you divide that by two.
Right.
And if
and
you have three
say.
Children, you divide half of that by three, right?
Mm-hmm.
Half of that. 369. Right. Okay. This is 331. Wow. So even if he's single, he's only going to get about 1.5 million.
I don't know. That's the tax.
That's
the tax.
Oh,
that's the tax.
That's
the tax.
That's
a lot of money. That's not it. Mm-hmm.
Okay, someone else do the first one. And someone go for example two. What?
You need assets worth
if you leave assets worth £500,000, how much taxes will you pay?
Would you then be paying taxes on the difference between the £325,000 and
£500,000?
So you take out your exemption to pretty much?
Nil bond.
Nil bond, that's
mm-hmm.
NILBAND?
L-I-L, yeah. Your nil bond.
So
IHT. How much would you pay?
£70,000.
So then do example two.
Hmm?
Next one.
Yeah, but that's what. Okay, so Mr. and Mrs. Young, they have assets worth $800,000 between them.
Mm-hmm.
He dies first and leaves $200,000 to the children.
Mm-hmm.
How will this estate be taxed and how will it affect this? So are you talking about a will here?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. How about his wife?
Oh. No bonds roll over.
So for the spouse, he is HIT exempt. Remember? And the spouse dies, his
mm-hmm.
nil bond goes to the wife.
Okay.
So he's exempt.
Okay.
That's how it affects the spouse.
So the children's would be separate from, so we would take the children's from this 200, from this 800,000?
No, the first thing is how will this estate be taxed and how will it affect his wife? For the wife, she gets this 325,000.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Plus hers. But hers isn't
mm-hmm.
kicking until
she dies.
So basically looking at one or two.
So I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
So in the first part of that example, and he leaves 200,000 to their children.
Mm-hmm.
That is under the 325.
Mm-hmm. So it's not taxed.
So it's not taxed, mm-hmm. but the balance would be 125. That goes to his wife then.
Mm-hmm.
She would pay taxes on that.
Mm-hmm. No, the 125 goes to the 325.
Right. And so when she gets out,
you understand?
Yes, I do.
You getting it?
As opposed to subtracting it.
Yeah.
So.
Okay, hold on. They can catch up. He left what? 800, right?
Yes.
And he's giving 200,000 to his children.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And 600,000 to her.
Right.
Okay? So he's given this outright, and he has a nail bond of 325,
right.
Okay? But he's only using 200 out of the nail bond. So the 125 transfers over here to her, along with her 325.
So she only pays 40% tax on the difference.
On the difference. Mm-hmm.
$60.
Okay. Okay, yes, I see that.
Mm-hmm.
So, why again do we take it out of the children's own again?
He has to pay tax on the $200,000 that he's giving.
The children?
Yeah, he has to pay taxes. And
who
because
who you mean?
The man who died. He has to pay taxes on this, what he's giving to his children. But he has an exemption.
Yeah.
An exemption is £325,000.
Correct.
Pounds, right? But because this is under the threshold,
yeah,
he's only using 200 out of this 350.
Right.
So then if he left them 100,000, she would then have to pay the 225.
No,
may
she would use that 225 to add to her 325.
Yeah.
Right,
to increase her nail bond.
Yeah.
Yeah, to increase her nail bond. She's good to get married. Now you see why they're advocating for civil partnership in the Bahamas.
Yeah, it's a benefit.
It will benefit them when it comes to this disposition of assets. Okay? So we got where to go from there, right? So, when we take her two nil bonds, the 325 plus the 125,
so
and we take it away from the
600,
then she pays 40% on the balance.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. See how easy this is?
Get the swing of it.
Get the swing of it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, y'all have some homework. No, this is in class. And of course, you know you have to keep your records for tax. There are some. Let me see what slide that is on. I have some more practice questions in your package. Calculating inheritance tax only on estate component. I have three examples. Near the end. You're fine. Near to the end. Yeah, those are some examples.
We will all work out.
Close to the end. There you go. Mm-hmm. Which are really good examples of the exam questions up there, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Which one?
So
which way is it?
47.
Yeah,
okay. Yeah, we do. Yeah.
That's an example.
That's an example. Yeah.
Okay.
So you need to practice these. You have me for two more Saturdays. So if you practice, you can bring it in. But you need to practice it. Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
So we can either do two things. I can finish this, or you can read it. Or when we come next week, we can go over those three practice questions. Which one you want?
The one where we can leave now.
Yeah. No, we have to leave now, but I'm saying when I can get next week.
Oh,
do you want me to do the couple slides that I'm missing, or you want to do the practice questions before I go into And then don't forget to have a look at the menu flash drive. This is the United Kingdom section, and they tell you how they deal with taxation on gifts and transfers. Okay?